knows me, I'm Jimmy. Thank you for coming to this great event. I think it's going to be awesome. I won't talk much. I want to introduce Jerome Robin from Boiron, France. He is the export manager for America. And he'll do the introduction and talk a little bit, and then we'll kick it off.
Thank you, Jimmy.
Merci.
Bonjour.
Bonjour tout le monde. So thank you. I'm very pleased to be there. Thank you, Jimmy. Thank you, Wayata. Thank you, everybody, to be there. We are going to assist to a great demonstration with Chef Michael, I know for a long time already. Chef Michael has been elected one of the best 10 pastry chefs in America when he was working at Tribute in Detroit. Michael has working 8 years at Le Bernardin in New York, and is now at ICE in Manhattan, which is a great location because we have been together there. We worked with Michael for several years, and we are very proud to get Michael on board. So before, we are going to have a look on a shortage video of a few minutes about the company, Boiron. Of course, I'm there if you have any question about the company. I know the company for more than 15 years. So I know quite a bit about how we do the fruit puree and so on, about everything. Just let you know that, for example, the passion fruit puree, we use 7 different crops, and we blend together to maintain the same level of bricks, which is crazy to make, but we have to do it. And so let's go with the video, and then we can start the demonstration. Please.
At the Les Vergers Boiron Company, there has always been a passion for fruits. Originally started to market the fresh fruits of the region, this passion has driven 45 years of constant innovation and growth, and allowed the company to become the worldwide leader in professional fruit purees. Now located in the Drôme department of France, the company is driven by its commitment to quality and consistency, and seeks to contribute to the success of food professionals by delivering to them nothing but the highest quality vegetable and fruit purees.
Et elle a été créée par mon grand-père, qui est originaire de la région ardéchoise, donc juste à côté d'ici. L'objectif était de commercialiser des productions, notamment ardéchoises, région d'origine de la famille, sur la zone de consommation de l'Île-de-France. Donc il a commercialisé des fruits frais. Mon père, lorsqu'il a repris l'entreprise, s'est tout d'abord intéressé à la surgélation des fruits, en fournissant aux entreprises industrielles, fabricants de glace, fabricants de confitures, des fruits surgelés. Et ensuite, il a pris un tournant qui a été de s'adresser aux professionnels, aux chefs, pâtissiers, glaciers, traiteurs, et en leur proposant tout d'abord des fruits surgelés et ensuite des purées de fruits surgelés. Et moi, j'ai repris l'entreprise donc il y a une dizaine d'années et je travaille à son expansion et son développement.
The company has been able to evolve constantly to adapt to the market and most importantly its customers. In 2010, the company grouped together their headquarters and production plants and opened a brand new facility in the heart of one of the largest orchards in France. This has enabled them to double production, and the facility includes high-tech processing as well as a research and development lab that enables them to study, test, and taste each harvest in order to provide the required consistency.
La préoccupation de notre clientèle, donc le pâtissier, le restaurateur, le barman, c'est d'avoir un produit qui soit régulier tout au long de l'année. Quand il fait sa recette, il y a une recette avec ses ingrédients, il doit pouvoir avoir le même produit tout au long de l'année, et ce n'est pas son problème qu'il y ait des années avec des saisons différentes, des climats différents. Et donc c'est tout le savoir-faire de la société Boiron d'être en mesure d'assurer une régularité de cette qualité.
Pour Boiron, la qualité, je dirais, c'est un état d'esprit. Ce sont les hommes et les femmes qui travaillent dans cette entreprise qui font la qualité.
And at Boiron, it is always the customer that comes first. As the worldwide leader in fruit purees, it is their mission to deliver nothing but the best ingredients to contribute to the success of food professionals worldwide.
L'importance des ingrédients est primordiale dans notre activité parce que
si on ne prend pas les bons produits, que ce soit pour les amandes, mais que ce soit pour les fruits, que ce soit pour la farine, quel que soit le produit que l'on doit réaliser, il est primordial de chercher et de trouver les meilleurs ingrédients pour arriver à faire les meilleurs produits. Et on a la chance d'avoir la qualité qui est aussi proche que le fruit frais avec les fruits transformés de la maison Boiron.
Ok, donc maintenant on peut recommencer. Michael, it's your turn.
Thank you. Everybody can hear me? Ok. First, thank you to Waihata, thank you to Jimmy and Lena, the whole team, Chef Matt. My first time to Hawaii, and their hospitality has been amazing, so thank you to them. And it's a special treat for you guys too, because you get Jerome as well as Maple, who handles all of the Boiron accounts west of the Mississippi River and obviously Hawaii. So I'm going to get kind of ambitious today. I have a problem where if I have a 4-hour demo, I'm gonna wanna try to squeeze in 6 hours of material. So we're gonna see how this goes. Since Jerome already talked about the company a little bit, here's all the stuff that we're going to try to cover today. We're gonna really focus on components that utilize the purees. The great thing about working with a group of professionals such as yourself is you all know how to make pastry cream, so I don't need to demo how to make pastry cream. But one of the things that I'd like to do, in addition to kind of showing off the Boiron purees, is kind of use this opportunity to talk to you as professionals and really get into some of the underlying science of things as we go along. So I guess just a little bit about myself. My current position is technically a part-time job at the Institute of Culinary Education in New York. I've been there for just about 5 years after leaving Le Bernardin for 8 years or so. And we kind of created a position that didn't really exist before. So my title is creative director, which I still don't know what that means in context of a culinary school, but it looks really cool on a business card. But what I do is I teach a few classes a month. I've been working on revising the pastry curriculum over time. I also do some guest lectures with the pastry students. I do a lot of marketing work. And for the last 2 years, I've actually been working on a bean to bar chocolate lab. So that's actually taking up more and more of my time, is actually making chocolate. And I'm hoping to get to a cocoa farm while I'm here over the next couple days. But everything I kind of do, and in addition to that, I also have 4 to 5 part-time jobs at any given point. Restaurant consulting, product development, things like being a brand ambassador for Boiron, of course. Almost everything I do, however, since leaving the restaurant, where I can now kind of take my time a little bit and think thoughts through to a complete end, everything I do is kind of about going back to the underlying science of things. Maybe taking some of the mentality that we might have picked up over the last 10 years, you know, kind of doing avant-garde things, and kind of just applying that scientific thinking to things that we already know in hopes that we can make it better. So I think of this in three ways. The more we understand, you know, what our ingredients are made up of and how they function in a recipe, just we make better products. We can also fix mistakes. You know, if we're just following recipes rotely without really knowing what we're doing, if it doesn't turn out, we don't know how to fix it. And then third, and maybe this is the more elusive part, is we can create new things. If we know X about this product, what if we applied it to Y and we can create new things? I don't think I've ever created anything myself, but hopefully one day I will. So let's talk about our first dessert we're gonna do, a verrine. It's gonna consist of three layers. So we have a milk chocolate crema, which is essentially a milk chocolate creme anglaise, tightened with a little bit of gelatin. So we have that set into the bottom of our vergers glasses already. Second, we have a coconut panna cotta. So this is using the Boiron coconut puree. If you look at the recipe, I'm using milk for this recipe, as opposed to using cream for the mango. And the reason why I chose milk with the coconut puree is the coconut puree already has a significant amount of fat in it. So I'm always wanting to keep things as light as possible, keep things as flavor forward as possible, and really just enough gelatin just to set it. The mango panna cotta, as I said, uses heavy cream, mango puree, a little bit of sugar, and just enough gelatin to set. Whenever I'm working with any sort of fatty mixture, especially if it contains milk fat and cocoa butter especially, is when I make these, I immediately blend them with a hand blender. And what we're doing in a sense is homogenizing the mixture. And whenever we have a hot panna cotta mixture, a hot cremeux, a ganache, all of these things, we have milk fat and we have cocoa butter in its liquefied form. As it cools, those fats crystallize into a solid. And by blending it, we ensure that we're breaking up those fat particles into very, very tiny and well-dispersed particles. And that will express itself as a creaminess and a richness. We're basically creating a better emulsion. Now, if I didn't blend this, would it be grainy? Not necessarily, but it wouldn't be as smooth as it possibly could be. So that's one thing I always do with any of these creamy mixtures, like I said, that contain milk fat or cocoa butter especially. Since these are set with gelatin, and we're gonna talk about gelatin and a few of these components that we're gonna look at today, but because we're gonna use some other gelling agents, it might be helpful just to kind of get a primer on gelatin. And we use gelatin every day, and we probably are familiar with a lot of these aspects of it. So what makes gelatin unique is it's a protein. It's an animal protein at that. Typically comes from a bovine or porcine, either from cow or pig, typically the hides and sometimes the bones. We would describe, and there's also fish gelatin, something I haven't played around with too much. I've started to work with it recently because it's a good option if you have to produce things that are kosher, for example. It sets slightly differently, so I'm kind of playing around with it to really understand it better. We're also familiar with the texture of gelatin, right? It's elastic, it's chewy. We would call that long textured, okay? It's also thermal reversible, meaning we can set it, melt it down, and then reset it with no problem. And what makes that easier is the fact that it has a very low melting point and a fairly high setting point. So it melts right around body temperature, which is what makes it so great as an ingredient. And then it starts to set at about 60 degrees Fahrenheit. And we all know how to work with it. We have to hydrate it in water, preferably cold water. We add it to something that's hot, it dissolves. When it cools again, it sets. It is obviously sensitive to alcohol, to acid, certain kind of fruits that contain enzymes that break down proteins. Papaya, kiwi, even figs have this enzyme. We can destroy that enzyme simply by cooking the fruit above about 150, 160 degrees Fahrenheit, and then we can set that with gelatin if we need to. Also, salt and sugars can affect the setting strength. So, what you can just, of course, at any point, just yell out questions because we're all going to fall asleep if we just listen to me talk for 4 hours. But what kind of gelatin is everyone using? Is everyone using sheets, powder, gold, silver, bronze, platinum, silver? I mean, it's typically we all use whatever our purveyors offer us. One thing that I never really understood until fairly recently, within the last few years, is that it doesn't really matter what the what kind of sheet it is, silver, gold, bronze, or platinum. A sheet always equals a sheet. If you notice, though, a gold sheet weighs less than a silver, weighs less than a bronze, but that also corresponds to its bloom strength. The bloom strength is actually based on a test you can give, a very specific concentration of gelatin. It's the amount of force that it takes to move a plunger through a specific proportion of gelatin and water. So the higher that bloom strength, the stronger it is. The lower that bloom strength, the weaker it is. But as you see from this chart, a bronze sheet is 1.5 times the weight as a gold. So a sheet is a sheet. So when you see a recipe that calls for 4 sheets of gelatin, it shouldn't matter whether you have gold, silver, bronze. Now it becomes tricky if you're reading a recipe, and sometimes I see this where it's simply giving a weight of gelatin sheets without specifying what the bloom strength is. And it gets even more complicated when you want to convert, say, from powder to sheets, or if you have silver sheets and then you have you need a particular weight of a different type of grade. There's actually a very complicated formula that you can do, and I'm not gonna leave this up for too long because I've kind of done all the work for you. So what we can do at the end of the demo, I'll take business cards, or we can get if you want to give me your contact information, or maybe we can do it through Jimmy, I'm happy to send you this presentation as a PowerPoint or as a PDF. But here I've done all the work for you, so if you ever need to convert from one type of gelatin to another, because there are different strengths, different weights are going to give you a different set, this can be very useful. When I used to have to write recipes for, say, more of a consumer magazine, and everything had to be in cups and tablespoons, and you're trying to convert gelatin sheets to a quantity of powdered gelatin, it was really, really difficult to nail down. But doing it this way, we can get a little bit closer. All right, so we've set our mango layer. Next, we're going to look at a really fun component, our mango pearls. This dessert that's actually up on the screen is a dessert that was inspired by a trip to a cocoa farm in Dominican Republic several years ago. It was kind of like what grows together goes together, because I was seeing pretty much in one view, I saw mango trees and cocoa trees, and we were drinking coconut water every day, and they grow cashews in Dominican Republic, and it makes sense that all those things would go together. But when you think about it, everything that grows together does kind of go together. I'm sure you guys experience that here with all the great produce that you have. So whenever we talk about these gelling agents, all these fancy white powders that we see everywhere, we often refer to them as hydrocolloids. What does that mean? If we break that down to hydrocolloid, we have water and structure. So hydrocolloids are simply something that gives structure to water. Gelatin, agar, egg yolks, they thicken things, cornstarch, flour. Hydrocolloids are all around us, even though we maybe don't use that fancy term. So we're gonna use agar to make these pearls. So I have some water here, and I'm gonna add the agar. We're actually adding a little bit of locust bean gum as well, and I'll explain why we do that. Set this behind me. And while that comes up to a boil, we'll talk a little bit about agar. So as opposed to gelatin, which is from an animal protein source, our agar is from a type of seaweed or algae. And its texture is completely different. So whereas gelatin has that long, elastic, chewy texture, agar typically has a firm, brittle, what we would call short texture. It's also thermoreversible. The catch is, though, you have to heat, if you wanted to reset an agar gel, you would have to heat that above 180 or 185 degrees Fahrenheit, which is pretty hot. And you'd probably have evaporation, so your secondary gel would set very differently than your first one. But because of that high melting temperature, agar is actually kind of fun to use for gels that you can serve slightly warm, which is sometimes a counterintuitive thing because we're so used to gelatin gelling things and we can't serve those warm. In addition to that very high melting temperature, it also has a very high setting temperature. Usually above 100 degrees, an agar gel will start to set. So it'll start to set fairly quickly, even at room temperature. Another big difference between agar and gelatin is that the agar really requires boiling and some subsequent simmering to fully hydrate, to fully activate it. And that's really sometimes the most difficult part of it, because a lot of people will often ask me, you know, for various reasons, you know, can I substitute gelatin for agar? Or sorry, can I substitute agar for gelatin in a mousse recipe? And the answer is, yes, you can, but no, you can't, because you're never going to end up with the same exact texture. And, you know, if you have a base that is set with agar, in order for it to cool down enough to, say, fold whipped cream into, it's already starting to set. And it's just, they're not really interchangeable in that sense. But that's why I say you can, but you can't, because I encourage people to at least try and see if they can figure it out. And agar gel is also very interesting because it's sheer thinning, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. So once I've brought this up to a boil, I then turn the heat down just a little bit, just to allow it to simmer for another minute or two. And because you'll see in the recipe, we're working with very small quantities, so it's only about 100 grams. So we don't want to boil that too extensively because it would evaporate off too much water. In the meantime, I have some mango puree and a little bit of additional sugar. And actually here I use a little bit of calamansi puree to add a little bit more acidity. Chef, could you just warm that up for me for about maybe 20 seconds? This was right out of the refrigerator, so it's very cold. So we're going to warm it up in the microwave just to take the chill off of it a little bit. So when we add this agar and water base, we're not cooling it down too quickly, so it won't set on us prematurely. One of the reasons why I prefer to hydrate the agar in water as opposed to mango puree is, in part, I don't want to boil the mango puree because that, you know, we're starting to ruin the wonderful flavor that it has already. And when we hydrate hydrocolloids, especially something like agar, which requires that boiling, it's helpful to do it in something that doesn't have other elements that compete for water, like sugars and even some non-soluble solids. So we want to hydrate agar in something as close to water as possible. And you'll taste it. We're not really diluting the mango flavor at all. All right, so we're taking that off the heat. Again, we just brought it up to a boil, gave it just a little additional simmer. Not too strong, because we don't want to evaporate off too much of the water. So now we'll add our mango, sugar, and calamansi. And you'll see in the recipes, sucrose, it just refers to granulated sugar. I'm kind of a nerd in that sense. Because we use several sugars, plural, in the pastry kitchen, I like to be kind of specific. But sucrose is just granulated sugar. I once did a demo where I probably referenced sucrose 50 times over the course of a few hours. And a week later, I got an email from someone who took the class, and they're like, Chef, I've been looking everywhere and scouring the internet. I can't find sucrose anywhere. Like, just granulated sugar. So. All right, so we're going to transfer this to a squeeze bottle. The key here is to make sure it stays warm and fluid, because again, it's going to start to set very rapidly. Maybe what I'll do is pour out a little bit to show you how rapidly it will set. Another thing, we'll talk about this a little bit later in detail, but another thing we want to really avoid is stirring it too much as it starts to reach its setting temperature, or agitating it too much, because then it can actually thin out and it'll affect the gel strength. So while this is still warm, what I have here is just some neutral vegetable oil. My preferred oil is grapeseed because it doesn't have much of its own flavor, but you could use canola oil, any sort of neutral vegetable oil. And it's chilled, so it's been hanging out in the refrigerator since Tuesday when I arrived. We want it to be below 40 degrees Fahrenheit. And then what we can do is we can just take this hot agar mixture and we're gonna just drip it into the oil. So what's happening here? The temperature of the oil is ensuring that these droplets set fairly rapidly because the oil has been refrigerated. But then the density of the oil, because it's so thick, it helps these little droplets maintain their spherical shape. If we were to do this in water, you know, this mango mixture would just kind of spread out and form, you know, irregular shapes. And we want to kind of preserve that spherical shape. It's kind of a mesmerizing thing to watch. Sometimes I refer to this as reverse frying, because we're applying this into cold oil. Now, in a production setting, for this, these little quart containers are totally fine. But in a production setting, what we would typically do is we would have a 6 or 8 quart container filled with oil that would just live in refrigeration. And it could be used over and over and over again. Because you really want to have the maximum distance for these droplets to fall to the bottom. If there's not adequate distance and time for it to hit the bottom, it might not set. And if it doesn't set until it gets to the bottom, you just end up with sort of a puck of mango gel at the bottom. So you want distance and you want to maintain the temperature. Because as I add more and more of this warm mango mixture, the oil is actually warming up a little bit, obviously. And now this is going to give us a completely solid set, of course. These are going to be solid all the way through. A little bit later, we're going to talk about some liquid center spheres as well, using a completely different method. I have probably attempted this technique with virtually every single of the Boiron purees, and they all work beautifully except for two, raspberry and pomegranate. And it was driving me crazy. The beads will form, but over time you get what's called cinereses. Water will start to weep out of the pearls themselves after just a few hours. Here you can see how this sets immediately at room temperature. I'm going to pass around and take a look at it. I don't know, has everyone worked with agar before? It's pretty common now. So yeah, for the spheres, agar is very stable over a range of pH, meaning you can have a very acidic puree like passion fruit or liliqua, as I've been learning, or calamansi or yuzu or any of these, and it's totally fine with a very low pH. Whereas some gelling agents, you have a problem with too much acidity. What I discovered with the raspberry and pomegranate in particular is that they both are fruits that have a large amount of what's called tannic acid. And that's one thing that agar doesn't like. So it's that tannic acid that's starting to break the gel down and you get that weeping of moisture out of it. I have heard, I haven't really experimented too much with it, but I've heard if adding just a little bit of glycerin to the mixture can inhibit that weeping. So we could go ahead and do this whole bottle. I'd like to leave it in the oil at least for a few minutes to completely set. I think with our small quantity here, we're fine. We'll let those set for a minute. We'll go on to the next component, which is our pistachio sponge. Another really fun technique. This probably emerged about 8 or 9 years ago, I'm thinking now, out of Albert Adria and El Bulli in Spain. Here we simply have pistachio paste, and I'm using a pistachio paste that has a little bit of color and a little bit of additional flavor added to it. It's always this kind of compromise you have to make when working with pistachio. Obviously we want the maximum impact of flavor, so using an unsweetened pure pistachio paste is kind of what we want to do. But then from a customer point of view, it's kind of expected that pistachio has some sort of green color. So I always try to kind of delicately tread that compromise because I don't want it to be neon green. But a little bit of a green color can be kind of pleasant. So this particular paste that I'm using here has a little bit of color added to it. So it's a pistachio paste, whole eggs, a little bit of sugar, a little bit of salt. And historically, or when I first started doing this, I was using all-purpose flour. And a few years later, after sort of seeing something that the Modernist Cuisine team put out in Seattle, they were using Wondra flour. Is everyone familiar with Wondra? It's basically flour that's been cooked and then ground back into a flour. So you could, if you're making a sauce or something, you could add Wondra flour directly to hot liquid and it won't clump up. It kind of made sense because if you're using this flour that's already cooked, because this sponge cake only, it cooks in less than a minute, maybe you'd have less of a floury, starchy taste. So I started using the Wondra. And then recently, a project I was working on about a year ago for a restaurant opening, we were doing this on a dish that would have otherwise been completely gluten-free, which we all have to be sensitive to, right? So I'm like, well, let's see if we can make this microwave sponge with rice flour to make it gluten-free, and it worked. So now I use rice flour. So this is a great component to add sort of that cake-like element without adding gluten, which is kind of tough. So loading that into the foam canister. When we're mixing it together, I simply just blend it with an immersion blender. I'll often strain it as well, just to make sure there aren't any little lumps that could jam up the canister. This is taking two charges, because really it's the gas that's the leavening here. We're not adding any sort of chemical leavener like baking soda or baking powder. So what we want here is eventually like a mousse-like consistency. Our baking vessel, a little paper coffee cup. I find that we get the best results by just poking a couple little air vents, both in the bottom and into the sides of the cup. A nice moussey consistency. I'll show you. And we're only going to fill these about a third of the way. All right, and then it's going to be into the microwave. Now, the wattage of your microwave definitely makes a difference. Let's give that 40 seconds. So it just so happens that the microwave we're using here is a fairly low wattage. You know, lower than what we typically find in a restaurant kitchen. So the baking time will vary, but typically somewhere between 30 seconds and 60 seconds. But these are really versatile. You can take this recipe and pretty much substitute this pistachio paste for anything that's of a similar composition. I'll show you later, I brought with me a black sesame microwave sponge that we're gonna incorporate into a dessert. Using any sort of nut paste. Even unsweetened chocolate works really well. Here's another one, Chef. So what we get is a cake, and I should probably let this cool off a little bit. We get a cake that's lighter than anything we could get from a conventional cake baking method, even from an angel food cake. And an angel food cake is great. It's really nice and light and fluffy, but you can't really flavor it, right? Because if you add something that isn't really concentrated, it completely ruins that light structure. But what we end up getting is a really nice airy texture that we can then kind of break apart and garnish desserts with. Okay. So let's finish this little vereen. I have some of the sponge that I've done previously. We'll also drain these pearls. I'm just going to drop these through a strainer. And then again, we can reuse this oil multiple times. I probably wouldn't throw this oil into a fryer because you are going to get some some little water droplets. I don't think that would be fun. Some people like to rinse these. You know, they claim that, you know, you can taste the oil, but if you're using a quality oil like a grapeseed oil that doesn't have its own flavor, I think it works really well to not strain them and just, or to not rinse them and just let them strain, maybe blot them on some paper towel. And in that sense, you still get a little bit of a shine. It keeps those pearls kind of nice and lubricated so they don't stick to each other. All right, so to finish, take some of our sponge. So just by show of hands, like who here is in sort of an independent restaurant sort of situation? Hotel? Resort? Most of you, yeah. Like a bakery or pastry shop? Okay. So mostly sort of resort hotel. I mean, these things are great for buffet. I mean, I don't need to tell you how awesome verrines are, right? You're probably using them all the time. Have some pearls that we've already made. And now, you know, these will hold up for, I don't know, 2 or 3 days is usually how I keep them. If you think about it, it's just like a fruit coulis that you would make as long as it stays chilled. You're good to go. Sometimes I'll just put a little bit of paper toweling on the bottom of the container just to absorb any additional oil. I also have here a little bit of chocolate decor. The milk chocolate that we use here for both the creme and the decor is the Felclin milk chocolate. So I'm just using a textured acetate sheet. Those are our verrines. Chef, would you like to assemble some of these? So these we can set aside since they're not gelled. Do a little bit of house cleaning, and let's talk a little bit now about applications in ice creams and sorbets. Who here makes their own ice cream and sorbets? Most of you? Okay, great. So I've kind of, over the years, become a little bit of a ice cream nerd, I guess, for lack of a better word. At the end of the session, you're going to understand this, I promise you. But this is one way that we can express ice cream. And I put this up here because I think we can all relate to this idea that, you know, as pastry chefs, we're often referred to as, you know, the scientists of the kitchen, whatever. You know, I'm not a scientist, I'm a chef. But I think we do have to think scientifically. And to the extent of what we do, we have to essentially predict the future, right? If I'm baking a cake, I'm kind of mixing things together in a state that is, while it's edible, it's not really palatable. You don't want to eat raw cake batter. And then we put it in an oven, and then we have to know what's going to happen to it a half an hour later when we take it out of the oven. We can't pull out our cake halfway through and decide, oh, I want to add a little bit more baking powder. It doesn't work that way. You know, a savory cook, if you're making a soup, You can tweak it, adjust it, season it from start to finish. We don't have that luxury in many cases. So what we have to do is predict the future. So what that really means is we have to be able to understand what we're doing and how we're putting things together. So anytime that I can reduce something down to sort of a nerdy equation, I like to do that. So yeah, when by the end of our session today, I'll kind of break this down to show you how this exactly represents ice cream. But it's helpful for us to understand what ice cream is, or really any frozen dessert. We can think about its structure. It's essentially a frozen foam because we're incorporating air, right? Even if we're doing a static frozen mousse like a semifreddo, we're incorporating air in some part, either from whipped cream or from a meringue that we're incorporating. And so it's a foam. It typically has a structure of milk fat. I like to think of the structure of ice cream as being sort of a milk fat scaffolding that as we spin ice cream, because we agitate it while it's being frozen, what's happening is all of those fat particles in the ice cream mix start getting jammed together, and they stick together, and they form a scaffolding that in turn then traps all the air that's being incorporated as it's being spun. The most important thing to understand, or the best, I mean, I could do this for 4 hours alone, just talking about ice cream and sorbet, but I'm gonna try to keep it pretty general. The big thing to understand about frozen desserts is the role of sugars, or all the stuff that can be dissolved into the water that makes up the sorbet or the ice cream mix. And when we have solids dissolved into water, it changes their properties a little bit. At the high end, it raises the boiling point, and at the low end, it lowers the freezing point. When's the last time any of you have seen snow? If you've been in Hawaii for long enough, maybe never in your life. Where I come from, and we just got a blizzard about 2 weeks ago, where I come from, when there's snow and ice on the ground, we throw salt on the sidewalks and on the roads to lower the freezing point of that snow and ice, so it has to get that much colder to freeze that that snow and ice. So we know that salt will both raise the boiling point and lower the freezing point. But sugars do that as well. And we call these properties colligative properties. What's gonna determine the ultimate consistency of your ice cream? The firmness, the softness. It's the amount of these sugars that you have dissolved into the mix and the types of sugars that you use. That's gonna determine the amount of ice that's actually created when you're freezing an ice cream or a sorbet. The rate at which you freeze it, meaning how quickly, will determine the size of those ice crystals. You know, so in a perfect world, we want to spin ice cream as quickly as possible. And you know, in talking about machinery, ice cream machines, you usually get what you pay for. You know, I have a machine in my lab that, you know, I can freeze 2 to 3 quarts of ice cream or sorbet in about 3 minutes. You know, but if you're using a tabletop machine that takes 45 minutes, chances are you're going to have very large ice crystals and then a slightly grainy consistency. And it's always important to remember, once we've made our sorbet or ice cream, that the minute it comes out of the machine, that's the smallest those ice crystals will ever become. They're never going to get smaller, they're only going to get larger over time. And that's something I see a lot in some of the restaurant work that I do, that you know, the product starts off really great, but it's stored at too warm of a temperature, or it goes through lots of temperature variations that allow those ice crystals to grow over time. Here's this kind of a little animation of a hypothetical ice cream mix that has a very particular blend of sugars. And as that mix freezes, what this curve shows us is how much of that water has turned into ice. So you'll notice these temperatures are in Celsius. So you know, once we get down to about minus 18, which we're looking at about 0 degrees Fahrenheit, so in a sub-zero freezer, there's still 20% of our water in our ice cream or sorbet that's still liquid, which is kind of a weird thing to wrap your head around if you've never thought about it. But it's the fact that all of those sugars are concentrated into that remaining water that keeps lowering the freezing point of that water. And that's what makes a frozen dessert scoopable in the first place, is the fact that these sugars will lower the freezing point. You know, if we change the recipe, you know, then that curve might change a little bit as well. So that means you might have more sugar, or we're going to talk about molecular weight here in a minute and how that correlates. So that just shows us that in that hypothetical recipe B, which has more sugars added, that the freezing point is lowered just by a couple degrees at the beginning, but once you get down to 0 degrees, you know, the percentage of ice is a lot less. How many of you, when you're making an ice cream or sorbet, how do you know when it's done? Nothing, we just let it go? You just open it up and look at the consistency? That's how most of us do it, and that's how most machines are set up to do it, unless it's, you know, we have machines now that we can, it'll beep when it's done. You know, a lot of times we don't even know how those work, but it basically usually has to do with the amount of force that the machine is using. Once it gets to a certain torque, it determines the ice cream being done. Really the best way to determine doneness is temperature. And unfortunately, not all machines actually read the temperature as you're spinning. I use Bravo machines, and it reads the temperature throughout the process. So what I usually do is I pull it at about -5 degrees Celsius or about 23 degrees Fahrenheit. And at that point, only about 50% of the ice has, or 50% of the water has turned into ice. But that's the ideal place to remove it from the ice cream machine. And then typically, what I like to do is put it into a deep freeze, like a blast freezer if possible, to finish the freezing process for the remaining water. Because the longer it stays at that temperature, the greater potential for large ice crystals. But then, of course, we want to serve it at a slightly warmer temperature. You know, so our service freezer that we're working out of is typically a little bit warmer, and that's really where shelf life comes into play. Because at that temperature, your shelf life of your frozen component is probably only a day or two. So it's really important to cycle the products. You know, either have a high turnover so it's not sitting at that higher temperature, or to make sure that it's being adequately refrozen to keep those ice crystals small. All right, so here's a very complex chart. Again, I've done a lot of work for you here, and I reference this all the time. What I've done here is I've kind of cataloged almost every sweetener we might use in a pastry kitchen, plus a lot that we don't, just for comparison's sake. But the first thing we can look at, and probably the most noticeable thing when we're formulating an ice cream or sorbet, is sweetening power. And different sugars, different sweeteners will have a different sweetening power. So sugar or sucrose being the bulk sweetener that we're most familiar with, that's some food scientists decided to give that a score of 100. And that is simply the perceptible sweetness of that sugar. But all these other sugars will either lie above that or below that. So for example, dextrose, which we use a lot in frozen components, has a sweetening power of about 75. So we could say it's 25% less sweet than sucrose. Often glucose is even lower. But things like honey or invert sugar are higher, like almost 25 to 30% sweeter than sucrose. And those are things that we always have to keep in mind when we're formulating something. Certainly if we are looking to substitute one sweetener for another. I mean, when I started out, before I understood any of this, you know, when I was still kind of the mindset that, oh, ice cream is just frozen creme anglaise, which it's not. It's way more complex than that. But I tried to, you know, make honey ice cream. So I'm like, oh, I'll just substitute some of my sucrose for honey. And I could never understand why it just never set up. It was always super soft and also very, very sweet. So sweetening power is really important. We can use different sugars like glucose and dextrose and invert sugar in addition to regular sucrose to balance that sweetness. Because, you know, as pastry chefs, what we do is we make sweet things. However, we don't want them to be so sweet that they start to obscure other flavors. Another really important thing with, especially when it comes to frozen components, is its effect on the freezing point. And that's something we can actually measure. And it's in direct correlation to a sweetener's molecular weight. I'm not gonna get too much into chemistry. I actually never took chemistry in high school. I'm kind of regretting that now. But every sugar has a molecular weight. And basically, the lower that molecular weight, the greater the effect on the freezing point it has. So for example, if you look at the chart, sucrose has a molecular weight of 342. Kind of meaningless to most of us. But if we compare that to dextrose is 180, so almost half. So what that means is that the dextrose will have almost twice the effect on the freezing point as sucrose will. So if we look at the column that says RFPD, if we give sucrose a factor of one, and we simply divide the molecular weight of sucrose by the molecular weight of dextrose, we get that number of 1.9. And what that simply means is that dextrose will lower the freezing point of water 1.9 times that of sucrose. So in other words, gram for gram, dextrose will lower the freezing point of water twice as much as sucrose will. So what does that mean? That means if we are in a situation, and often we can fine-tune recipes based on our freezers, because we can't always change our freezers, but we can certainly fine-tune our ice creams and sorbets to be workable out of a certain freezer. So if we, for instance, we need a softer ice cream at a lower temperature, we can simply replace some of our sucrose with dextrose. Plus, we get the bonus of it becoming slightly less sweet, too, which is good. What if we wanted to make a firmer consistency at a higher temperature? We could add some glucose powder. If we go down the rows to glucose powder, here the molecular weight is above sucrose. And as you go higher, that sweetener has less of an effect on the freezing point. So adding a little bit of glucose not only makes it less sweet, but it makes it a firmer consistency at a higher temperature, which is often probably more applicable than trying to make it softer at a colder temperature. So we can use all these sugars to really fine-tune a recipe. So if we start talking about sorbet, here's just a general, very, very general breakdown of the proportion, the percentages of all these ingredients we might use. Awesome. Thank you, Chef. So for example, the main bulk ingredient, what's flavoring our sorbet, can comprise as little as 25% or as much as 70%. Now, if you start looking at these other ingredients, you're going to see, well, water, that doesn't add up. That comes above 100%. But often, our flavoring ingredient is going to include a fair amount of water. What's really important is simply understanding that a sorbet base is really nothing more than water and everything that's not water. And everything that's not water, you'll have a small amount of non-soluble solids. So we're using a fruit puree. A couple percentage points of that are just solids that, won't dissolve in water. But the rest of that is sugars. And then we have the added sugars. So added sucrose, whether we add glucose powder or dextrose powder. Typically, we don't often add dextrose to sorbets because our fruit purees have high amounts of natural fructose, which if we were to look at fructose on our chart, it has a very low molecular weight and thus a very great effect on the freezing point of water. So very rarely do I actually find myself adding dextrose to a sorbet, but we use it a lot in ice cream. Invert sugar we can use. We'll talk about invert sugar a little bit later. Sometimes I actually like to use a little bit of non-fat milk powder, especially with purees like yuzu or passion fruit or citrus that have a slightly higher water content. a little bit of milk powder can actually sort of soften that ice cream. It'll prevent iciness, which can often occur with those flavors because there's simply less solids to start out with. Our stabilizers, of course, which account for a very, very small amount. What do our stabilizers do? They simply slow the growth of those ice crystals that will eventually form. Altogether, we want a solids content somewhere around 30%. This is another interesting chart that's kind of a combination of some technical information of the specific boiron purees, plus a few other things, and a great source of kind of ice cream knowledge that I got several years ago from a French pastry chef, Olivier Bajard. He runs a school in the south of France, and he was really one of the first chefs to do classes around this. You know, none of this stuff is new to the ice cream industry, but it's often new to pastry chefs because we just kind of inherit recipes and we make them. But the more we kind of live with this understanding and knowledge, we can kind of create recipes out of thin air. And I'll show you kind of how I do that. But what this chart simply shows us, and this is a lot of this information just comes from the actual package of the puree. What's great about the boiron purees is it's not a blanket amount of sugar that's added. You know, some purees, it's 10%, no matter what it is. What Boiron has done, and when I visited, I got to see their laboratory where they test the fruits. They're adding just enough sugar to arrive at what they feel is the ideal amount for that particular fruit. So the ideal balance of acids and sweetness. And they also give you that sugar content or the Brix level on the package itself. So all that stuff is very useful for us when we try to create a recipe. We know what the solids and the sugar content is. So here we have the total solids content and the water content, and then the amount of that solids in the form of sugars. And it's usually just a percentage or two that are the non-soluble solids, and we don't really have to worry about those too much. The pH, the acidity, those are kind of averages. Obviously, fruits are different based on time of year and ripeness. But again, that's a great thing about using a frozen puree is that you know what to expect every time. The pH is fairly consistent. And then this last column, and again, this becomes really useful if you want to just start to build these formulas on your own. This is a very broad range, however, of how much of that puree you would use to flavor a sorbet or ice cream. And it kind of gives you a ballpark to start with. So if you look at something that's very, very intense, like passion fruit, bolokoi, it could be as little as 30%. You know, whereas something a little bit weaker, you know, we'll look at pear. You know, typically minimum threshold would be 50%. So these are all things, tools that we can use to help us kind of fine tune our own recipes. You know, another thing that, you know, I was a fan of Boiron long before I started working with them, and part of the reason for that was too is that they were really good at providing technical information for us as pastry chefs. And one of my favorite things, and you should have a couple of them in the bags there, are those pamphlets that have parametric recipes for pot de fruits or ganache or pastry cream. And obviously, because every fruit puree is different, every recipe is going to be slightly different. I still use those all the time as a reference point. And you can always take that as a starting point and adjust it to your own needs. But I find those incredibly useful. What you don't have in the bag, you can always go to the website to download as a PDF. There's also the app. I don't know if you're aware of the Boiron app that has hundreds of recipes on it at this point. But all these things are great tools, and the company's been really great about offering that technical support. Obviously, any ingredient that we're adding, we have to know its composition. We have to know how it's going to affect the final outcome. So we know a fruit puree has water and it has sugar in it. It's helpful to know how much of each we have. But if we're making something with a chocolate product, you know, it probably has a little bit of sugar, unless we're using unsweetened chocolate or cocoa powder. It also has cocoa butter. Cocoa butter is a solid at room temperature, so it's definitely going to be a solid when it's frozen. So cocoa butter is definitely going to affect our consistency. I mean, usually, again, usually if I go to a kitchen that has, you know, an assortment of, you know, five or six ice creams, chocolate is always the hardest. It's the hardest to scoop because they're not formulating for that additional cocoa butter, which is going to make the consistency much, much firmer. Anytime we add a liquid flavor, even if it's a concentrated extract or compound, it's helpful to understand that it's water and there's probably some sugars in there as well. Nuts typically add fats. When we add dairy products, sometimes we're adding fats, sometimes we're adding additional water, we're adding milk protein, we're also adding lactose. Lactose is, even though it's, if we go back to our sugar chart, the sweetening power of lactose is like barely perceptible. If you've ever tasted, if you've ever gotten a chance to taste pure lactose, it doesn't taste sweet at all. Yet if you look at its molecular weight, it's the same as sucrose. So when we're formulating an ice cream, all of that lactose, which can be almost 4 to 5% of an ice cream base, it's really important that we account for that in adjusting the consistency. And alcohol, that's one of the most common questions I get is, you know, I want to make a boozy sorbet, but it's always too soft. So again, if we look at the molecular weight of ethanol, which makes up alcohol, it's very, very low, 46 compared to 342 for sucrose. So a very small amount of alcohol will lower the freezing point exponentially, 7 times that of sucrose. Salt is a little bit higher. Salt is about 54 on the molecular weight scale. So, you know, you wouldn't add enough salt to an ice cream to lower it that much because it would be very noticeably salty. But here's an example of how I would formulate for including an alcohol. At most, I would probably add 5% of pure alcohol to a sorbet or an ice cream. Beyond that, it starts to get too soft. So this was an example of a sorbet I've made in the past, a cucumber gin sorbet. So basically what we want to do is we want to start with our total yield. So this particular recipe, based on how it was written, gave me a yield of 1,700 grams. Okay, and also in addition to deciding what my percentage, my desired percentage of alcohol is, I should cut back on the sugar content. So my solids content, instead of being 30, can be as low as 23 to 25%. So I'm cutting back on my sugars to account for the fact that I'm adding alcohol. So basically I'm just figuring out, okay, 3% of 1,700 is 51 grams. But now gin is not pure alcohol. There's also water. So we have to look at the alcohol content, which is 44%. And by just doing a little bit of math, we determine that 115 grams of gin will give me my desired 51 grams, which is 3% of our total sorbet base. So it's just a little bit of math that we can do, but it's helpful rather than just kind of go by eye or go by taste to really kind of zero in on a percentage and understand how we arrive at that. Again, these parametric recipe charts, I don't know, to me they're worth their weight in gold, even though the paper doesn't weigh that much. But for every single flavor, and every few years, these are updated and revised. This particular year, I think this was from a few years ago, they were suggesting other like enhancers to complement those flavors, whether it's an alcohol or a compound or a basil or an herb or something like that. But these are great places to start to experiment. Again, kind of going back to my, we can probably start to scoop while I'm talking. Kind of going back to my nerd sensibilities. At one point a few years ago, I decided that, you know, simply having my recipes in Word document form weren't good enough. And just by looking at the recipe, I couldn't always visualize what the percentages of these recipes were. So what I did is I came up with a spreadsheet. I'm still trying to figure out if there's a way to, I don't want to say monetize this, but I think this could be like blown out into an app or something. I mean, would any of you use an ice cream formulation app? Yeah? Okay, so I have like 40 people who would buy my app. So what I can do here is I can basically plug in a recipe, and I have all the formulas calculated where it gives me the percentages. So here's the passion fruit sorbet that you're going to taste. And huge thanks to Chef Ron, who spun all of the frozen items for us today. Yay, Ron. So you're going to taste the passion fruit. And just by plugging in the recipe that you have in the handout as well, we can immediately see the percentage of all these ingredients. You know, so here, you know, if we look back, you know, general proportion of passion fruit would be somewhere between 30 and 45%. And here we're just shy of 40. So that means we're going to get almost a maximum amount of passion fruit flavor. You know, we're using glucose powder, again, to adjust the sweetness, but also to adjust the consistency. Our stabilizer is, of course, affecting both the texture, but also resisting or inhibiting ice crystal growth. But you also see here, if you look across the columns, you see columns that say SP and RFPD. Because I have that sugar chart, and every sweetener has a score for sweetening power, and every sweetener has a score for its freeze point depression, I can actually quantify the sweetness of a sorbet, and I can quantify the consistency of it. Now, for you, saying 319 for its relative freeze point depression, that's just a number that makes no sense. But if you kind of use this system and start to compare recipes, you know, if I started to get to 250, you know, I might have an icy sorbet, or if it gets above 350, it might be too soft. So if you kind of adopt this method of analyzing a recipe, all of a sudden, just by plugging in a recipe into a chart like this, you can understand a lot about it. You know, here we see the total solids is 32%, again, within that 30 to 33% range. You know, so what you can do with a chart like this is you can start to play around with the recipe and see all of these values change. Now, I've also given you, the recipe for my kind of sort of base recipe. And, you know, again, all of these fruit purees are slightly different, and they're going to require a different base syrup. I've been in a lot of situations where people want like one magic bullet, one magic syrup that's good for all purees. And it's really, really difficult to do that. But what I've done here is I've also included, because sometimes we need to do that, depending on our operation. If you look in the recipe handout, you have two bulk sorbet bases. Now, obviously, the main difference between the purees, you could divide them into very acidic purees, like our citruses and our tropical flavors, and then what we would call sweet purees. And what I'm giving you is a recipe and then sort of a dosage chart for these flavors that will get close to what we would get if we had, what I would call a bespoke syrup for each flavor. That's how I would obviously prefer to do it, but sometimes I've been in situations where you need that kind of one size fits all syrup. And I kind of just gave you that for reference. You know, if we were to kind of toggle back and forth, I'm not going to spend too much time on it here, but if we were to go back and forth between these two, you could see how the values change slightly. But let's look at ice cream, because ice cream is a little bit more complex. Instead of just being water and sugars and non-soluble solids, now we have fats, which you know, change the perspective considerably. But this would be a very broad range of percentages of ice creams. And we typically look at an ice cream based on its milk fat. So to legally sell something as ice cream in this country, it has to have minimum 10%. Gelato often falls below that. So that's why if you were to go to a store and buy gelato, you will never see the word ice cream on that package because you can't legally use that term. You know, it'll say something like gelato, Italian frozen dessert or something. Your high-end, your highest-end gourmet ice cream will have probably up to 15 to 16% fat. Egg yolks, I've actually, for the most part, I've done away with egg yolks. When I first started doing ice cream classes, I did side-by-side tastings of sort of my standard recipe and a bunch of recipes that didn't incorporate egg yolks. And my standard recipe tasted like an omelet. But it wasn't until tasting it side-by-side with egg-free recipes that I really noticed that. So I pretty much shunned eggs, and with a few exceptions. So the actual percentage of egg yolks is fairly low. The non-fat milk solids, those are the proteins and the lactose in milk and the cream that we're using. But we often add additional milk powder to boost that content. Then all of our sugars, our stabilizer, and again, our water content is going to be somewhere between 55 and 64%. And again, the same things apply. In understanding how to formulate, we have to know what each of our ingredients brings to the table. Obviously milk is going to supply water and fat and non-fat milk solids, but even dry milk powder is 3% water. And when we really kind of look at how to formulate, we want to take that water into account. Sometimes our sugars also have water in them, especially if we're using invert sugar or glucose or things like that. Here's just a rough composition chart of the most common dairy products we'll use. For me, I almost always use a 35 or 36% cream. My recipes are written for that, but again, I've been in kitchens where all they have is 40%. And even though you might not think 4 or 5% difference would make much of a difference, but it can be a huge difference. So I would have to adjust, with an ice cream or a ganache especially. So here's the same sort of formulation chart for an ice cream. So now we have fat as part of the mix. We have a white base, and you have the recipe for this that comes in just at 10% or a little bit less. Usually our non-fat milk solids content is around 10% as well. And again, I have the sweetening power and the freeze point depression all calculated. The total solids for an ice cream is going to include the fat, even though the fat doesn't affect the freezing point of the water. But it's usually going to be closer to 40% rather than 30% for a sorbet. Now, obviously, if we go from here to starting to add fruit puree, there's always a tendency to want to just take a white base like this and add our fruit puree on top of it. Well, what are we adding? We're adding a lot of water, but we're also adding more sugar, but usually a higher proportion of water. So raspberry puree, for example, is going to be perhaps 80% water. So we're adding a lot more water on top of what's here. We're probably going to have a very icy, hard ice cream or gelato, if that's what we're going for. So what the great thing about the recipe charts that you can get from Boiron is they factor that in. So this recipe here that you have for the raspberry ice cream, and actually this is more of a gelato type formulation, much less fat to allow more of those fruit flavors to come through. Here the recipe accounts for all of that added water and sugar. And again, I can send this to you and you can look at this on your leisure to fully understand it. Again, I can't stress enough, the fact that the amount and types of sugars that you use will determine how much of the water in the base turns into ice and ultimately the consistency. But the size of the ice crystals is how quickly you can freeze it. And again, once it comes out of the machine, the ice crystals will never get smaller. They'll only get larger. All right.
When is that the app going to be available?
My app? When is my app going to be available? I don't know. I need funding, I guess. All right, so let's move on to the next one. They're probably all tired of listening to me talk. We are going to talk about pâte à choux. Before we talk about pâte à choux, however, we're going to make the filling for the pâte à choux that we're going to look at. Here again, we're going to use the passion fruit. And we're essentially going to make a mousse to fill our choux puffs. And that mousse is going to start off essentially as a curd, like a lemon curd. How I typically like to start a curd is to combine my sugar and eggs first. So we're using whole eggs here, and we all know that whole eggs often have those little bundles of egg whites, right, that can sometimes create little lumps, especially when we add eggs to a liquid. So if we simply combine our sucrose and whole eggs and really whisk those together first, we can kind of break up all those lumps. Because once we add water, they'd be really hard to break up. So usually I just whisk together the eggs and the sugar, and then I'll add my liquid. So in this case, it's the passion fruit puree. This recipe is pretty much interchangeable with any acidic puree. Yuzu, calamansi, lime, lemon. Maybe once you get into like blood orange and mandarin, you might need to cut back a little bit on the sugar. All right, so now that I have that in, we're gonna start to heat. You'll notice I've left the butter out. A lot of very traditional curd style recipes will call for adding the butter at the very beginning, where the butter gets completely melted in the cooking process, obviously. For the same reason that I like to always blend fatty mixtures, I like to add my butter at the end of the process as this base is starting to cool, so that I don't remelt this the milk fat that's in the butter, which is already in very small droplets, really well dispersed. Again, it's not necessarily going to guarantee that I'm going to have a grainy end result if I add the butter now, but it certainly wouldn't be as smooth as possible. So I'm going to cook this, and then as it cools, I'll add the butter to it. All right, so we've all made lemon curd. We've all made crème anglaise, right? So how do we make crème anglaise? What's in it? Milk, cream, sugar, egg yolks. We usually heat up our liquid. We temper it into our egg yolks. And then we have to be very, very careful as we cook that, right? How do we know when crème anglaise is done? Does it make a line on a spoon? To me, that's problematic, because what if you're using a rubber spatula or a wooden spoon or a regular metal spoon? It's going to coat those different surfaces very differently. So to me, that's too subjective. Like, I always want to measure. I always want to be exact and precise as possible. So, what temperature do egg yolks start to coagulate? At about 180, 185 degrees. So I always cook a crème anglaise mixture to a specific temperature, and that way it's always consistent as well. We all know that if you have four or five different cooks making the same thing from day to day, that the consistency can change from cook to cook, right? So I always use a thermometer when cooking something like that. But we have to be very gentle, right? If we overcook it, we have essentially scrambled eggs floating and milk. Pastry cream has basically the same ratio of ingredients, but with added starch. And it's that starch which allows us to boil the pastry cream, right? It inhibits the coagulation of the egg proteins. With a curd, it's usually the high sugar content. So the more sugar you have, the higher the coagulation temperature. Here, if we go back to the slide here. If we think of a protein as a little coiled up piece of string, when we apply different forces to proteins, that string starts to unravel. And whether it's in an egg or a steak or in flour, all proteins kind of start off as little coiled up pieces of string. And depending on these different forces, they kind of unravel. And we call that unraveling denaturing. And usually that denaturing will affect the consistency or the texture of whatever we're talking about. So obviously heat will denature proteins. We all know that heating things changes the texture of things that have proteins in them. But also just mechanical action. So just whipping. You know, when we make a meringue, it's in part that whipping, which is denaturing the egg white proteins and thus stabilizing an egg white meringue. You know, if you've ever eaten ceviche, you know that lemon juice or lime juice will cook fish proteins. So acid will also affect the way proteins denature. And we also have enzymes that can denature proteins. And once you unravel a protein, you can't get it to curl back up again. You can't uncook an egg, so to speak. So a great way to visualize this, you know, we have coiled up pieces of string. As we add heat to them, they sort of unravel. Once we get to a certain temperature, again, what we call coagulation temperature, all of those coiled up pieces of string stretch out and they start to lock in with their neighbors. And we essentially have a network of protein that then traps water. And that's where we get, you know, from a liquid to a solid. That's actually one experiment I did, is I wanted to see, you know, what happens to an egg when it goes from its raw liquid form to a solid. So I basically just hard boiled a bunch of eggs and measured them before and after, weighed them before and after. And, you know, does the water content of a hard boiled egg change at all? Not at all. To a tenth of a gram, the egg weighs the same. But all of that water that's in the egg in a liquid form is now just trapped in this network of protein. All right, so I just brought this mixture just up to a boil. And again, it's the sugars and the acid which allows us to boil it without scrambling it. Of course, we can scorch it, by all means. In this case, because we're going to be making a lighter mousse out of it, we want a little bit more stability. So we're going to add some gelatin. This I've actually just had hydrating overnight. And typically, I like to hydrate gelatin in just enough water, not much more water than it's naturally going to absorb. So gelatin typically will absorb only about 4 to 5 times its own weight in water. It's really unnecessary to use copious amounts of water to hydrate gelatin. And often when we do that, we always run the risk of, as we're squeezing it out or trying to remove the water, we, you know, especially if we do it with our hands, we can melt it due to the warmth of our hands, or we lose some of the gelling strength if the gelatin sheets break up in the water. And I've even heard it suggested that the length of time that you allow the gelatin to hydrate, longer is better, rather than leaving it for 5 or 10 minutes. If you can leave it for 15 or 20 minutes, you'll get a better hydration of the gelatin. So adding that off heat. And I think what we'll do, just for time's sake, we're going to file this under the do as I say, not as I do category. I am going to add the butter while this is still kind of warm. But what I'm going to be sure to do is to add it while blending. So if we cook this properly, we don't necessarily have to strain it. And part of that is due to the fact that we mix the eggs and the sugar together first, so we lessen the likelihood of any lumps of egg. As long as we don't overcook it or scorch it, we should be good. So even if this is slightly warm, at least while blending this in, I'll ensure that those fat particles stay small and well dispersed. In a perfect world, what I would do is I'd let this cool down to almost room temperature. right at about 35 Celsius, 95 Fahrenheit, which for you might be room temperature, right at the melting point of the fat and the butter itself. Again, just to ensure that we're gonna get the smoothest possible texture. Ideas on how to chill this down rapidly? Can I make that your job? How to chill this down very rapidly? I'll make that your job. All right, all of our butter is incorporated. Thank you. So while Chef is gonna chill that down, we'll whip some cream. Now, I always made my cooks whip cream by hand, unless they were doing a massive amount. Because as you know, we can go very quickly from under-whipped to over-whipped in a matter of seconds, especially with a small quantity like this. But I'm gonna go hands-free so I can talk a little bit about what's happening as we whip cream. So if we can go back to the presentation. Who here has ever had raw milk straight from a cow? What kind of differences between raw milk straight from a cow, you know, what differences are there between that and commercial milk? Usually people say the flavor. I mean, part of that is you're drinking milk from one particular cow, so you're probably tasting what that particular cow has eaten. But also, what I usually hear is people say, you know, it seems richer, it seems fattier. Again, that could be a function of that individual cow, but it also has to do with the fact that milk fat has a natural tendency to separate from the water that makes up the milk. We call this flocculation, so that milk fat, because it's less dense than the water it's floating around in, it'll rise to the surface. It's reversible. If you shake up the milk, it'll disperse again, but eventually it'll collect and rise to the surface. That's not really commercially preferable. So that's where homogenization came in. You know, so most milk is pasteurized, meaning it's heat treated to reduce the bacteria count. But it's also homogenized right after production or right after pasteurization. And I'm sure it's much more complicated than this, but I like to think of homogenization as shooting the hot milk through a shower head. And you can kind of imagine what happens. You're shooting it through tiny little holes in a shower head, and it effectively breaks up all the milk fat particles into smaller particles and evenly disperses them. In a sense, you're creating an emulsion in what was previously something where the fat would separate out. So the milk that we buy at the store or use in the kitchen has been homogenized. It's all that fat is evenly dispersed. So milk fat has that tendency to separate. We fix that with homogenization. When we're whipping cream, I won't go back, but if we were to look at the composition of heavy cream, in this case it's a 36% fat cream. It's 36% fat, probably about 58% water, and about 6% non-fat solids, the proteins and the lactose in the cream. You know, if we were to shrink ourselves down to the size of a fat particle, you know, what's happening in this bowl as that whip is going around? It's kind of like a mosh pit of fat particles. If we all kind of stood up and started running around the room, we'd eventually bump into each other. And when cream is cold and the fat in the cream is a solid, when they collide, they stick. And as more and more of those fat particles collide together, more and more of them stick together, and they form, like I was mentioning before with ice cream, that fat scaffolding. And because we're using a whip as opposed to a paddle, you know, the whip gives us a lot of surface area and incorporates a lot of air. And that air gets trapped in that fat scaffolding. Now, if I were to ask you to describe the consistency of perfect whipped cream, meaning whipped cream that has the most volume, the most air whipped into it, but also the most stable strongest structure. How might you describe that type of consistency? No one? Nobody whips cream? We all outsource everything now. Well, a few years ago, I would have said, okay, whipped cream that is most stable and most strong, at its strongest, firm peaks, right? Because firm is strong. It's actually not the case. Perfectly whipped cream in terms of volume and stability is actually fairly soft, and it's kind of counterintuitive. I don't want to take this too far. But especially if we're, say, making a mousse like we're doing here, if we have stiff peaks, we've actually kind of started the downward path towards butter. So in other words, if I were to draw a curve, and at one end we have liquid cream, and at the other end we have solid butter, because we all know we get butter from cream, right? So as we start to whip, we incorporate air, and the very, very top of that curve would be that ideal whipped cream, the most air, the most stable fat scaffolding, for lack of a better word, it'd be fairly soft. And as we start to get stiffer, we actually go on that downward slope towards butter, meaning too much of that fat has been jammed together. And when too much of it gets jammed together, it becomes less stable. We start to lose water, and it starts to weep, and it starts to break down. It'll start to look grainy in appearance. And you can't, just like you can't uncook a protein, you can't unstick a fat particle once it's gotten stuck together without heating it. So, you know, if we were to use over-whipped cream, we know what happens if we try to use that in a mousse. You know, it takes longer to incorporate, meaning we're just knocking more air out of it. Sometimes it actually gives us a grainy texture, especially if it's something that's going through a freeze-thaw cycle. It might shrink or lose water. But the first time you kind of wrap your head around this idea, it seems, again, counterintuitive, like the cream is not whipped enough, it's too soft. But really what we're looking for, maybe just a little bit stiffer than that. It's a small amount. This is only about 200 grams that I'm trying to whip here. So we would call perfectly whipped cream, we would say that the fat is partially coalesced. Coalesced just meaning to come together. As we get to butter, we start to, again, go on that downward slope towards full coalescence, which is great if we're making butter, but not if we're making a mousse. All right, so I'm gonna call this as my perfect whipped cream. Now, you know, if I were garnishing a cake and I wanted a little rosette of whipped cream, obviously this isn't gonna cut it. I'd have to whip it much firmer, but just with the knowledge that I would either need to use some sort of emulsifier stabilizer, or that it's just gonna break down over time. Okay, so I'm gonna set this aside. We're chilling on our curd base. So basically, we don't want that curd base to set, but we want it to be cool enough that we can add the whipped cream without it deflating and melting that nice fat scaffolding that we just developed. So let's talk about pot au choux. The recipe that you have there, it was kind of the result of a lot of experimentation. You know, and it's one of those things, pot au choux is something that, you know, you get a recipe when you're in culinary school or if you work for a mentor. Well, like, why do you need a new one? Pot au choux is pot au choux, and it's mostly about what you fill it with, right? This is why I was still at Le Bernardin. You know, I was, you know, thinking, you know, how do I refine it even more? So I really started to look at the ingredients, and even though the basic ratios of those ingredients aren't going to change too much, there's still a lot we can do within those ingredients to kind of tweak it as we go. So if you look at the recipe, I like to use both milk and water. You know, if we were to use all milk, we'd have a much a darker puff and one that's more tender. Why? Because we're adding fat and we're adding proteins and sugars in the form of the non-fat milk solids that are gonna encourage browning. If we were to add water, it'd be lighter in color and a little bit drier. So that's already something that can be useful. A lot of recipes that I've seen in my travels, and especially in researching how to make a better one, sometimes you don't even see any salt or any sugar at all. I mean, even in a savory application, I like to use just a little bit of sugar and even salt. The flour, I found that a little bit more gluten gives you a little bit more extensibility, and thus the blend of all-purpose and high-gluten flour or bread flour. And then the eggs, I mean, the eggs are always going to be, you know, a fairly consistent ratio. But one thing I've found, and I think it might be a little bit different here because your climate doesn't really change. I mean, you're kind of within that zone where you have basically a year-round temperature and humidity for the most part. But I know for me in New York, when I'm making pot au choux in January, it's very dry. I might have to add a little bit more egg. If it's in the middle of August when it's very humid, I have to add a little bit less just because there's more humidity in the air. Sometimes we can even take into account the moisture content of our flour. Anybody guess the moisture content of flour? We usually don't think of it having any water, but it can be 10% or even slightly higher. But as flour ages, it tends to get drier, or if it's stored in an area with low relative humidity, it'll be drier. So all those things can, you know, again, you know, you want things to be predictable and perfect and very objective, like this is how it should be. But with the eggs, it's always a little bit more or a little bit less for that very subjective, you know, not too runny, not too stiff. We all know what that is. What I've done kind of differently here, instead of making the pot au choux and piping it out, as much as I think manual piping skills are very important, you know, we have so many tools available to us now that can give us very consistent size and shape of things. And a lot of people don't even realize that, you know, pot au choux, you can freeze it. You can even make it and chill it for a few days. So actually, this pot au choux here, I actually made this in New York on Monday and froze it so it would survive the trip, and actually baked off what you're gonna have today this morning. So it was either frozen or refrigerated during that whole time. Yesterday I piped it into these silicone molds, these half sphere silicone molds, and then froze them so I could take them out. And then before baking, I like to temper them back to room temperature just so they're not frozen when we start the baking process. So now if we were just to go like this, we have, again, beautifully perfect, consistent size and shape of our choux puff. However, you'll notice the recipe after the pot au choux is this choux sablé. And what this is gonna give us a kind of like a crunchy shell. And ever since I started doing this, it's hard to go back just to plain pot au choux. Like once you go crunchy, you don't go back. So how I like to do these, I'll unmold them. And also using this technique, you can stay, I'm always thinking about production, especially for high volume. You're half an hour away from finished pot au choux as long as you have these in the freezer at any given point, because you can just unmold them, temper them to room temperature, and bake straight away. So before these start to soften, we'll take some of the choux sablé. If we look at the proportion of the ingredients here, they're almost equal parts butter, sugar, flour. And in essence, it's the same proportion of ingredients that we would use for, say, streusel dough. You know, streusel we typically mix minimally just so it's still kind of crumbly, and then we put it on top of a muffin and bake it. Here, we're basically taking that same proportion of ingredients and mixing it to a homogeneous dough, which we then roll or sheet out into a very thin sheet. I did this by hand, but you could probably do this in between parchment on a sheeter. And then we'll simply punch out discs that are slightly larger than our half spheres of choux. Because, you know, that half sphere has a lot more surface area, so we need a little bit extra. So we'll simply place these on top and let these continue to temper. You know, and this has best worked from the frozen state. otherwise it'll get too soft and sticky. You know, but as the sablé itself starts to thaw, it'll just kind of slowly drape itself around the choux. And whether I'm doing, you know, crunchy choux or just conventional choux, I typically will start at a fairly high oven temperature, anywhere between 350 and 375 to get kind of maximum oven spring to start. And then once you've started to develop a little bit of color, you know, the choux process is really just about it's all about drying out. So what I'll typically do, I think what I ended up doing today was these took about 20 to 25 minutes. And I did the first 5 minutes at 350, then turned the oven down to 325 for about 10 minutes. And then for the remainder of the time, finish those at 300. All right. So finished product, once we bake these, just kind of maybe a quick poll. If we were to bake these uncovered, like side by side, which one do you think would have the most volume? The one with the sablé weighing it down, or the one without?
The one with.
The one with? Why do you say that? Okay, well, it was kind of a trick question because here's one with and without, and it was the same size. I'm not trying to fool you. It's almost twice the size. I don't know if we can get a closer up. Here we go. If you think about what stops the puffing process, it's basically the outside of the choux starts to dry out. And it can't expand anymore. But when you have this sablé draped over it, it kind of protects it and allows it to expand even more. And you know, the very specific ratio of ingredients here, this almost streusel-like dough, it has high amount of sugar and butter to flour, means that it will grow with the choux. You know, when I first started doing this, I had, you know, just sort of a normal pot sablé that I'd use for a shortbread cookie. I'm like, that'll work. No, it doesn't, because it doesn't have that high proportion of fat and sugar that's going to expand with the choux. It just kind of like set immediately on top without expanding with it. And actually, that actually did weigh it down. So those are the small ones and the big ones here. And you'll see that, you know, you get full coverage except for the very, very bottom. Is anyone doing this technique already? Yeah. Okay. I said, once you go crunchy, it's hard to go back to just a normal pot of choux. All right, where are we on use? Still a little warm. Actually, not too bad. Again, as long as we're below 95 degrees, we'll be able to start to mix our cream in without it deflating and melting down. So this particular recipe will really work well for sort of a freestanding mousse or parfait as well. Questions? So when we're folding, I always like to do sort of a double action where I'm not only folding with the spatula but also turning the bowl as well. I kind of get double the incorporation with half of the effort. what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to let this set up just a little bit so it's a little bit firmer for us to pipe into our shoe. And then we'll quickly take a look at the next set of recipes. Chef, do you think I could get a half hotel pan? Excellent, thank you. Just gonna let this set really briefly in the freezer, just so it firms it up a little bit. And Chef, if you would like, we can start to just poke a little hole in the bottom of each of these before we go on. It's kind of interesting if we compare the actual physical structure of ice cream with whipped cream, it's almost identical. And what we have here on the left, we have whipped cream. So we see big air bubbles. Those are the, sort of the bluish purple orbs. And then you see that little kind of scaffolding, that little chain of the yellow fat particles that kind of create that structure which traps the air. And then the little raspberry looking things are actually milk proteins that kind of help in that process. And if you look at the right, it's identical except for the fact that the water that's in between all those air pockets and fat particles is turned into ice. But it makes sense, you know, if we overspin an ice cream, it starts to get grainy, or we've coalesced too much of that milk fat together, and it almost takes on like a frozen butter kind of consistency, which frozen butter should sound good, but it's not, right? All right, we're gonna look at the calamansi tart next. Calamansi, of course, being the lime that's indigenous to the Philippines, although somebody who was at our event yesterday said that there's a local calamansi that goes by a different name, but I can't remember what that name was. Correct me if I'm wrong. But we're going to look at pot sucre. The recipe you have here is kind of my new go-to recipe. It's made in a food processor. You know, so if you look at the ingredients and the method, we start with very, very soft butter. Like basically it's butter that is soft just to the point before it starts to turn melted, essentially. Super soft butter that we whiz up in the food processor with our sugar and our almond flour. Then we add our egg, and then a portion of the flour first to really get that incorporated, but only a portion so that we don't overwork the gluten. And then adding the remaining flour just to the point where it's incorporated. And this is a really great base recipe. The calamansi custard, here, let me grab the tart shells. So what I like to do to really preserve the shape of these tarts, I'll usually do a blind bake. You know, so I just have some beans that are wrapped in some plastic film that I just put right in there. Actually, in recent years, I started using rice over beans because beans tend to get that burnt bean smell when you use them, but rice doesn't as much. And also it tends to fill in those gaps a little bit better. And we want to pre-bake those tart shells pretty much completely. Because during the second baking, when we're adding the calamansi custard, it's not really going to gain much more color. This calamansi custard, this is something I like to make a day in advance. We're simply taking heavy cream, whole eggs, a little bit of supplemental egg yolk, Here it says pasteurized egg yolks, but it doesn't necessarily need to be pasteurized egg yolks. I've always liked to use pasteurized yolks because we tend to use more yolks than whole eggs or yolks and whites. Our calamansi puree, and again, this will work with any of the kind of very strong acidic purees, and our sucrose. We're simply blending this together with a hand blender, and because of that, it produces a lot of foam. If we were to bake that off straight away, typically during the baking process, we would lose a lot of volume because putting it into the tart shell straight away, a lot of that volume is air that would get kind of knocked out during the baking process. So I'd like to make this, you know, a day or two ahead, and that allows time for resting for all that air to kind of dissipate out. Okay. We could use a dropper, or simply just pour these in. And I also like to do this second baking with the ring around it, just to make sure that it doesn't go anywhere. And the baking temperature, I like to do you know, anywhere really between 250 and 275 Fahrenheit, really, really, really low and slow. So we almost never run the risk of overbaking. We know we've overbaked a custard like this when it starts to kind of souffle out of the tart shell, and that's not really what we're looking for. So the finished product, after it's baking, and again, just so it sort of has that slight jiggle in the center, will give us a really nice, soft, smooth custard on the inside. We'll look at some of the other components as well. I actually decided to skip the meringue today in favor of a bonus component. So we have the sucre, the custard, and I'm going to show you something else that's kind of fun, something I call a gel sponge. If we could go back to the presentation. There we go. So I'm also not going to do this live because of the fact that it takes about 20 minutes with the mixer going full blast. How many of us have made marshmallows? Okay, most of us. How do we make marshmallows? We typically have a sugar base that's cooked to a certain point past the boiling point. To give us a certain solids and water content. We pour that over hydrated gelatin, or sometimes we incorporate that into a meringue mixture that incorporates gelatin, and then we whip that till it's light and fluffy and let it set. Marshmallow has a very high sugar content. It also has a very high gelatin content. This component is a lot lighter, and that's a little bit more fragile. But allows us to almost get sort of like a, almost like a sponge cake-like consistency. So what we do is we start with water and sugar, and we simply heat that just enough to dissolve the sugar and then to dissolve the gelatin that we add to it, and then combine that with some of the calamansi puree, throw that onto the mixer with a whip, and basically whip it till it's cool. And as it starts to cool, that gelatin will start to set and it'll start to incorporate air, just like a marshmallow. When it gets kind of like a thick kind of shaving cream kind of consistency, or light whipped cream consistency, I just pour it into a little frame like this that's been wrapped in plastic and immediately freeze it. So our finished product here, and this took quite a while to whip yesterday, probably because of, you know, just a little bit higher room temperature with all the appliances on. I'll pass this around too, just so you can take a look at it. Thank you. So I'm going to just cut this into a few little cubes. and we're going to use this as a garnish. So I like to cut this and keep it in the frozen state, and it really it tempers to room temperature very, very quickly. That back in the freezer. We're going to talk next about our calamansi fluid gel. So fluid gel, it's a term that all the kids, the cool kids, started using a few years ago. What is it? We'll go back up to the presentation. We just made a curd, right? In that case, it was passion fruit. But let's say we're making a lemon curd, or in this case, a calamansi curd. We have a high proportion of sugar. We have a high proportion of fat in the form of egg yolks and butter. What are two things that obscure flavor? Sugar and fat. Don't get me wrong, I love lemon curd, but it's more about the fat and sugar than it is about the lemon sometimes. And the fact that all of those ingredients get boiled together. So the more you heat something, the more fresh, volatile flavors you kind of cook off. So this idea of, you know, a fluid gel in comparison to something classic like a lemon curd was really exciting when I first discovered it. Because we can get something like the same consistency of a curd, but a very light, less sweet, fresh expression of the same flavor. So if we look at the recipe, we have water, we have agar, some sugar, and in this case, the calamansi puree. And we talked about cooking agar earlier, so I won't do it again, but just like we did with the pearls, we're hydrating the agar in the water. And if we were to actually look at the proportion of agar in both of those recipes, this would be about twice the amount, at roughly, you know, 1% of the total of the recipe. What we end up getting is almost like a rubber ball consistency. Very, very firm. It's not something we would want to eat, or it wouldn't be a pleasant texture for us to eat in this form. But if we chop this up, we add it to a blender. Again, maybe I'll pass around a couple of these pieces just so you can see how firm they are. Again, this is, you know, kind of a textbook example of how agar is that kind of firm, brittle texture, which is quite different from, say, something like gelatin. If we go back up to the presentation, if we look at agar again, we'll emphasize this last characteristic, the shear thinning characteristic. What does shear thinning mean? Well, shear thinning is, well, there's a branch of physics called rheology, which is basically the study of how materials flow. We've all probably worked with chocolate. We know that chocolate is probably one of the most complex, well, melted chocolate is one of the most complex fluids there is. Its characteristics are highly dependent on temperature and the amount of cocoa butter crystallization and the amount of cocoa butter and the size of the particles. Very, very complex. On the other end of the spectrum is water, which water is pretty straightforward. If you apply force to water, the water moves. When you remove the force, the water comes back. We all know how water works. But there are other substances that don't behave like water does. Physicists refer to water as being a Newtonian fluid, named after Isaac Newton. And then anything that doesn't behave exactly like water is called non-Newtonian. And an agar gel, among many others, are non-Newtonian. When we apply force, or shear is another word for force, if we were to whip it, if we were to buzz it up in a blender, it'll actually get thinner. And we're actually exploiting that property of an agar gel to give us a transformation from this very firm, rubbery consistency to a very smooth, creamy consistency. Here we want it to happen. Sometimes we don't want it to happen. So say I was making those agar pearls, and say as it was cooling, if I whisked it too vigorously, or what if, remember we warmed up that puree slightly, what if I added, you know, ice cold puree to the cooked agar and water mixture, the temperature would drop significantly, and as I stirred it in, I'd actually start to get some thinning, meaning the pearls wouldn't set as firmly as they should. Here we're actually doing this on purpose. So I'm gonna start this out slowly. It can be kind of difficult with a small amount like this. So we're gonna see sheer thinning, but some things are sheer thickening. The whipped cream that we made, it started out as a liquid. When we applied shear or force, or when we whipped it, it got thicker. It turned into a solid. Some things are what we would call thixotropic, meaning if we apply force, its consistency changes, but then over time, it'll revert back to what it was before. Like if you were to take a slurry of cornstarch and water, at just the right ratio, you could actually form like a little ball with it if you rubbed it. But then as you let it relax and rest, it would turn back into sort of a liquid slurry. Ketchup is thixotropic. So if we're trying to empty ketchup from a bottle, yeah, sure, it's the inertia and the gravity of shaking that bottle that's getting it to come out of the bottle. It's also as the ketchup flows through the neck of that bottle, it's creating friction, which loosens it ever so slightly. And then once it hits the plate and sits on the plate for a minute, it thickens back up. It's very slight, but it's actually measurable. So once we started to get a little bit of puree going, we can turn the speed up here. But the result here now is that we're gonna have something similar in consistency to a calamansi curd had we done a traditional preparation, but the calamansi itself was never cooked, so it's gonna be very bright. We can control the sugar, because remember when we make a lemon curd or a calamansi curd in this case, if we were to do that, it's the high sugar content which dictates the characteristics of that preparation. And we have none of the fat, none of the egginess, none of the butter to cover up that bright fruit flavor. So this kind of sauce or cream has become a really, really useful tool since chefs figured it out. There are other substances which will have the same effects. Certain kinds of pectin are sheer thinning. We're gonna look at that later. Carrageenan, gelatin gum, they all have similar sheer thinning properties. Again, a small quantity. It's actually kind of difficult to do in here sometimes. But you'll see, you know, we went from that very hard, brittle gel, and we're slowly getting our way to a smooth, kind of almost creamy consistency. And it won't revert back to that firm gel. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna quickly empty this out. And I gave you a bonus recipe, which I'm gonna throw up here as well. This is something I started playing around with maybe 2 or 3 years ago. And it was an attempt to kind of do the same thing, kind of replicate a pastry cream consistency, but to do so without using eggs or without using starch. Because not only does fat and sugar obscure flavors, and kind of dull your palate, but starch definitely kind of coats your palate and inhibits flavor release of things like fruits and other ingredients. So the same basic idea, except we're using, in this case, dairy products. So we have milk, we hydrate the agar in the milk. Once that has come up to a boil and simmered for a few minutes, then we add the heavy cream and the sugar and a little bit of salt. And that's what we have here. So again, we have a very kind of firm, brittle milk gel, which, yeah, you taste this now and it's kind of actually disgusting to taste milk in this form. But because of the agar, it's sheer thinning. Now the great thing about this is now it's really easy to add flavor onto this. I mean, the possibilities are endless. You know, we could certainly add a fruit puree to this to make sort of like a fruit flavored pastry cream. We could probably just sub out some of the heavy cream or some of the milk. Obviously, we could add vanilla. I've added chocolate. I've done infusions. So I used to do a dish that was sort of a millefeuille or Napoleon of just different milk chocolate preparations. And the cream component was a milk chocolate crema like this that was, the milk was infused with toasted rye bread. So it was like milk chocolate and rye, had very kind of interesting malty flavors. And the great thing about this is the consistency, you can put it in a squeeze bottle or a pastry bag and pipe it like a little mound of it or a ball of it, and it perfectly holds its shape. The only caveat to this one, and again, a small quantity, it's going to take it a minute to get going, is that I like to either let it come to room temperature before blending it or actually just warming it up slightly. Because, you know, what do we have here? We have a lot of milk fat that's solidified I made this yesterday. So that milk fat crystallized and solidified. And now when I blend it, I'm getting that coalescence of milk fat, which can, you know, if I overdo it, which is often the case in trying to blend something like this, I end up with kind of a grainy, broken consistency. But as long as we warm it slightly, we can kind of re-emulsify that. So I just simply poked a hole into the bottom, and we'll take this passion fruit mousse. Still a little on the soft side, but it'll set up. And we're just gonna fill them like that. Okay. Chef is gonna take care of that while I finish the calamansi. And now just to show you the consistency, so we had that very, very firm milk gel. But once it's fully blended, it's got a really nice creamy consistency, but it's still, it holds up on the plate really nicely. And it can be flavored with anything. I just kept it kind of neutral for today, but just wanted to give you that recipe and show you the technique. So what we'll do is we'll take another of our finished tarts. One thing that I often like to do with these, I would usually do it before baking the custard into it, is simply to trim the edges of the tart shell with a microplane like this. That can smooth out any rough edges. So, I'm actually going to hit this with a little bit of confection sugar as well. Of course, this kind of a tart could be large format for your tasting today. I did some of the prefab tart shells that Hata sells. We've all been there, right? Having to use a pre-made tart shell. So some of our cream puree. You know, maybe, you know, another cool flavoring for this would be to infuse the milk and cream with some fresh ginger. I think a ginger component with this tart would be really nice. Some of our calamansi fluid gel. And then we have our gel sponge. Again, it's ideal to keep this frozen. Somebody was just asking, you know, how long does it hold up once it's on something? As long as you don't touch it and you're not trying to move it, you could probably preset it onto a dessert and then, you know, like on a buffet, and it can sit for a while. Something like this could be flavored with virtually any puree. Like I have in the recipe here, I like a little bit of like a dry, crispy meringue as well. And we'll kind of accent the lime flavor with a bit of fresh lime zest. Another question that I was asked during the break that I mentioned that I was using locust bean gum in addition to the agar for the mango pearls, but I never explained what it does. That very, very small amount of locust bean gum, which is also known as carob bean gum, sometimes it'll, especially in European products that have it, it'll be referred to as carob bean gum. It's basically just a thickener. It doesn't really form a gel like gelatin or agar or other hydrocolloids will. It simply thickens. But what it does, it has what we would call a synergy with the agar. So the agar is very hard and brittle. What the small amount of locust bean gum does is soften that firm, brittle texture. So it doesn't mean it's setting weaker, but it just kind of inhibits that brittle nature of the gel. Does that make sense? So a very little bit can just soften it slightly. If you don't have it, you could certainly leave it out. But the pearls themselves would just be a little bit more firm or have a little bit more bite to them. Are there any other questions from the first half? Makes me nervous when there are no questions. It makes me think you're bored. All right. That's okay, I can hear you, I can repeat the question.
If you don't have the locust bean gum, do you want it to be a little softer, less than the agar?
Yeah, you just run into the problem with then your pearls would be too soft. Another thing that you might be able, something that would work possibly in a similar fashion, be a little bit of xanthan gum. But you'd probably want to use a little bit less, because xanthan gum, when overused, has a very kind of a weird elastic consistency. So maybe, you know, instead of 0.3 grams of locust bean gum, maybe 0.2 grams of xanthan gum. But again, it'll work with just agar for sure. But to really dial in the softness of it, the locust bean gum helps. So Chef Matt is gonna work on the choux. So we get something else to taste, and we'll also do a small sample of the calamansi tart. So So we use these cute little guys. I'm going to move on to the raspberry pistachio tart. Here we have the same pâte sucré that we did for the calamansi. The only thing I did here, this is going to be, well, I'm going to do two versions. I'm going to do sort of a large format, sort of an open face tart, if that's even a thing. And what we did is we rolled or sheeted out the dough and cut it to the size that we want. But then I baked it on, put these on something. I baked it on one of these sort of mesh silicone mats. I know like there's one brand that they refer to them as a silpan or a siliform. I can pass this around if you've never seen these. These were actually kind of designed to use for bread baking. You know, silicone is great because we can get all kinds of cool shapes. But silicone, you know, if you've ever baked, you know, say a financier with, you know, a silicone mold, it's never going to brown the same as baking it in a metal mold, right? That's because silicone is a very poor heat conductor. But when you have a mesh like this, you get a little bit more heat conducting from the pan that you're baking on. So, you know, this was kind of marketed to bread bakers. But what's kind of cool when you do something like a pâte sucré on it is you get this kind of cool, I don't know, you'll have to get up close to see it. But it gives you this cool little kind of grid pattern, which just is kind of fun. So I have a sort of a large format, a smaller format. That wasn't me that knocked that over, was it?
No.
Okay, good. I'm making enough of a mess up here. All right, so I have a large format sucré base, a smaller format, and then we'll also do one that's kind of baked inside of a conventional tart shell. Okay. The next component that we have is a pistachio cake. This is basically a pistachio frangipane made with almond paste, some pistachio paste, the same pistachio paste that I used for that sponge cake, that microwave sponge. This particular one happens to be Sevarome. It's just, it's the one that I have the easiest access to. But I mean, I like pre-gel and Fabri, and there's all kinds of. I'm not sure what why Hata carries pre-gel. Yeah. And what's great about the pre-gel products is they have a range from, you know, a toasted, pure 100% pure pistachio paste through to a, you know, a very bright green blend of pistachio and almond. You know, when you really need that kind of light green color. All right. So what I've done here is I've spread this into a tart ring essentially, and baked it just until it comes together and it didn't really brown, because I want to keep this really super moist. So it's a really thin layer. Again, using a tart ring as a guide in this particular tart shell, I just baked it into the tart itself after blind baking the tart shell. I'm going to set this aside until we're ready for it. And then, as you saw with the cream puree and this calamansi fluid gel, I also did a raspberry fluid gel. Same technique, agar, hydrated in water. Combine that with raspberry puree that never sees heat, a little bit of sugar. Here, a little bit of citric acid. Again, just to brighten up the fruitiness a little bit, because we do have to dilute it with water. And we're just going to blend this until it's smooth. Mm-hmm. have a little bit greater quantity here, so it should be easier. But again, this started out as, you know, again, a firm raspberry flavored rubber ball, but we've loosened up nicely. We're going to actually use this almost like a jam. Again, the benefit of using this in place of maybe a raspberry jam is, again, a jam or a preserve has been cooked. So we're preserving a little bit of the freshness of the raspberry a little bit more here. Those we need to garnish before we serve. Maple. Those we need to finish before we serve. But the shoe is fine. Okay, so I have the raspberry fluid gel. So yeah, these little guys will just do just a little flop. Flop. And then we can do a little piece of the gel sponge. Thanks, guys. Okay, so now that I have the fluid gel and scissors, I can use this kind of like a jam. Now, granted, it has a higher water content than a jam or a preserve, so if it's something that's going to sit around for a long time, I might have to be a little bit careful that I don't, you know, my tart shell base doesn't become too soggy. But this is also going to kind of act as a little adhesive to stick the pistachio cake. I'm going to go just shy of the edges. And maybe for this guy, I'll just do a thin layer. So we're going to set those aside. Next, we have this raspberry crema. I made this ahead just because it needed adequate time to freeze. And it's essentially just like the mango and the coconut panna cottas that we did for the verrine, in the sense that it's whole milk and heavy cream. Here we have a little bit of glucose syrup, which sweetens it, but only slightly, because it has a lower sweetening power than sucrose does. And plus, we have other ingredients that are adding sugar. The glucose is also going to aid in the consistency. Gelatin to set it. We also have white chocolate. So the white chocolate's going to give it a little bit more richness and body, again, because we have cocoa butter. And cocoa butter, of course, is a solid when it's cold or at least room temperature. So that's going to give it a little bit of body, in addition to the gelatin. Okay. So again, these are previously frozen. So we have for our large format crema, and again, I'm using tart rings to set these. You know, we could also use like a silicone form that would give us these disc shapes of various sizes. So we have our raspberry crema, we have our pistachio cake. I also made a glaze. If you're a pastry chef and you look at Instagram, you would think that, I don't know, the Russians are like sort of the cake, entremet, glaze masters, right? I don't know how that happened. Good to know you. We can all relate to that. So what I have here is a gelatin confectioner sugar based glaze. I was hoping that it would stay kind of warm where it was sitting. I'm going to have to warm this up a little bit. So we could certainly use puree here. But I chose not to because I wanted to give you sort of a neutral base that you could build upon. Because sometimes if we use a lot of a glaze like this, we want a neutral base that we could then color or flavor to whim. But certainly we could substitute some of our liquid, some of our water in this case, and replace it with some fruit puree. What I did is I add a little bit of red color and a little bit of a raspberry compound. Our ideal working temperature is going to be somewhere around 85 to 90 degrees. I'm going to keep these frozen until just the point when we need them. While we're waiting for that to warm up, I'm going to come back to my pistachio cake. Take our small one and put it on our small base. It's really important with this pistachio layer that we don't overbake it. It can dry out very quickly when it's so, so thin. See where we are temperature wise. How's everything tasting so far? Okay. Looking good here. It's just a little on the warm side, so I'm going to let it sit. Let's go back to our presentation just to see if we missed anything. So let's see, we've talked about our pot sucre, our pistachio cake, our crema, our glaze. We have already made the fluid gel. Okay. I decided, just for time, like I said, I could go for 8 hours if you guys want to hang out for an extra 4 hours. I could probably go for 8 hours, but I decided to cut a couple of the recipes, but I can at least talk about this one that we're cutting. This coconut cream cheese parfait was actually inspired by red velvet. You know, it's one of those things that it's existed for a long time, and then it kind of caught on mainstream, and everybody has to do red velvet everything, or at least they did for a few years. And when I was at Le Bernardin, you know, at that level of service, you know, you don't say no. I mean, most of us in this room, we don't say no to whatever the request is. So, you know, we would do birthday cakes and anniversary cakes and special occasion cakes. And we kind of had set things that we would sell, you know, a chocolate mousse cake and some sort of fruit option. But we always had people call up and have very, very specific things that they wanted. I remember the night, it was Aretha Franklin. She always came in on her birthday. I don't know why she was in New York on her birthday, but she came in and one year she wanted a gumdrop flower cake. And I'm not a cake guy really, so I had to Google gumdrop flowers to figure out how to make them. Pretty obvious after that fact. But you know, somebody would ask for a red velvet cake, and I'm like, that's fine, we'll say yes, but I want to do it my way. So this dessert kind of evolved from that. So instead of making, you know, just the red velvet cake layers and a cream cheese icing, we made a cream cheese, like basically like a cheese mousse, like a no-bake cheese cake mousse kind of a thing, and set that into a ring like entremet style with the cake layers in it. And then it kind of made sense. I had never seen anybody do it. I'm sure I'm not the only one to think of it, but you know, red velvet, what happens when you spray something with white chocolate? It looks like velvet. So I would kind of do a little bit of a white and red spray to kind of, you know, amplify the idea of velvet. So that's how that started. And then adding coconut seemed like a really logical idea. And so what this dessert is it's basically that same idea with a red velvet cake component, the coconut cream cheese mousse, and then a sort of a, you know, I call it strawberry coulant. Coulant's just the French word for flowing. So it's sort of a barely liquid center strawberry puree, just set with just a tiny bit of gelatin, a little bit of invert sugar to sweeten it. We haven't talked about invert sugar yet. Where does invert sugar come from? It's made from sucrose, right? Just regular granulated sugar. And if we think about what sucrose is, here we'll get technical again. You know, sucrose, from a chemistry perspective, is what we would call a disaccharide. Di meaning two. So one molecule of sugar is actually two molecules glued together, one fructose and one glucose. And as, you know, one fructose and one glucose molecule glued together, sucrose has all of the properties that we know sucrose to have. But if we subject sucrose to water, heat, and acid, we can actually split those two molecules apart. And in essence, that's what invert sugar is. It's a process called hydrolysis, where you add water, add acid, add heat, and you end up with invert sugar, or tremoline is a, you know, sort of a brand name for that. What's interesting is how its properties change. So invert sugar, the sweetening power is about 125 compared to 100 for sucrose. Obviously, you know, invert sugar is sort of a, I might have used all of it. It's sort of a, you know, kind of a semi-liquid paste, and it's roughly 75% glucose and fructose and 25% water. You know, we use it in things like cakes to hold in moisture. It actually is better at binding water than sucrose is. We use it in ganaches for the same reason, to lower water activity. And you can actually make invert sugar yourself. Is everyone familiar with Sam Mason? New York pastry chef, was the pastry chef at WD-50 for many years. He has a ice cream business called Odd Fellows, and he makes his own invert sugar. But most of us just buy it. All right, so we have our crema discs.
Does it make a difference if you use citric acid or tartaric acid?
The question is, does it matter what kind of acid you use? I don't think so. Because really the ultimate pH that tartaric, citric, malic acids, it's really close. It's more about the source of where they're from, as far as I understand. So we have our frozen discs here. Let's have a little grate set up. See if these are as shiny as those Russians. did an entremet class at ICE a few months ago. And sometimes, you know, I don't know if I'm making this look easy or difficult or painful or what, but sometimes when you're trying to talk to people and entertain people, like some of the details of what you're doing kind of start to elude you. And I was doing a chocolate glaze of some entremets, and I just put the grates right on the tabletop and just started going at it with nothing underneath to catch it. It's like, it's what we call a teachable moment. I'm gonna pop this in this refrigerator. So I just want that glaze to set just a little bit before I try to move it around. Next, since I have this great flavorful fluid gel, and I have some raspberries, why don't we make the raspberries even more raspberrier? Because the cool thing about a raspberry, it's got a hollow center, right? So we can take some of our fluid gel and pipe it into the center of our raspberries. I've also done this with, you know, lemon curd, a pistachio cream, depending on which way we wanted this to go. Chilies just enough for the glaze to set, but not so much that the raspberry cremoso starts to thaw, right? So right on top of the pistachio cake. Oops. Obviously, we can reuse that that glaze, anything that's left over. Just get this a little bit more centered. There we go. So now to build these up. We can simply take some of our raspberries and line the tart with it. These are some monster raspberries. I hate to imagine how much Mexican raspberries are here for you in Hawaii, but they can't. Probably not good for your food cost. Huh? So we'll just pretend that these are filled. So if our dimensions are right, we actually hide that pistachio cake. So it's a little surprise as we cut into it. Huge. on this particular tart, we don't actually see the sucre. This is, we have a little bit more surface area on the smaller one. We will see that a little bit. As I get older, I love powdered sugar more and more. I don't know why that is. I also have some very finely ground Sicilian pistachios. But I like this idea of making a raspberry more raspberrier. So there's a large one, we'll do one of these smaller ones as well. All right, any other questions? Here for about another hour. So Jimmy kind of opened up a door in talking the last few days, seeing as that chocolate has become a big focus of mine, you know, in addition to just standard pastry stuff. I don't know. We were talking about maybe coming back at some point. If not with Boiron, then maybe to talk about chocolate. So I'm not going to talk about chocolate today. I'll leave that as a big tease for you. All right. I would eat that. All right, let's turn our attention to the next set of recipes. Let's look up at the screen and see where we are. Black sesame panna cotta, one of my favorite desserts going way back. This was actually on the menu at Le Bernardin for the last couple years I was there. Inspired a lot by working with a Japanese pastry chef or Japanese chef as his pastry chef for many years, you know, exploring Asian ingredients. I think when I started doing this, or started working with black sesame, it was something you didn't see very often. And you know, when you really think about it, there's not really a lot of black or gray food, at least not that we think is attractive. But when you have this, you know, kind of black and gray panna cotta with all these other colors, it makes these other colors pop. And to me, it's just a really beautiful looking dessert. So we're gonna start, we'll talk a little bit about the panna cotta itself. Like a standard panna cotta, we have, let me go find it, here we go. We're set with gelatin, we have some milk, we have some cream. I'm using a black sesame paste that I buy already ground up. This I just buy at the Japanese market in New York. I like these little pouches. So when you get it in jars, you know, who knows how long it's sitting in a box on a shelf and it separates, and it's almost impossible to get that homogenous again. So at least with these little packets, you can kind of massage it till it becomes homogenous. So I'm gonna demo a plated dessert version of this. The lychee sorbet, again, thanks to Chef Ron, very straightforward. Again, if we were to compare this, you know, the base syrup formula with the passion fruit, it's very different because lychee and passion fruit are very different fruits with different acid and sugar contents. But the finished sorbet is gonna have the same basic properties in terms of sugars and solid content and all of that. We're gonna come back to the mango spheres. The black sesame pain de gen. What used to be kind of an obscure French cake, I don't know, seemed to come into vogue several years ago. A lot of the French pastry chefs working in the States started using it. It's essentially an almond paste based, say that 10 times fast, almond paste based cake. I don't know, I like to consider it kind of the French version of a pound cake because it's nice and dense and very moist. And here we're using almond paste and, again, our black sesame paste. So I'm gonna cut these into little cylinders and put those on hold. Here has access to like blast chillers in their shop. I never worked with one until I started at the school, and I can't imagine life without one now. So what's really cool about this, and at first I thought it was kind of I was disappointed. I thought it was a defect. You know, even blending this with a hand blender after everything comes together while it's still warm before depositing it and freezing it, it's homogeneous. But as it sets, even when you put it right into the freezer and the time it takes to solidify and then eventually freeze, you get a little bit of settling of some of the sesame solids. So they settle at the bottom of the mold, what will be the top. And at first I was freaked out, like, oh, how do I fix it? But then I actually like the way it looked. Like if we can go back to the photo, you can kind of see how it's darker black on the surface than on the sides. You kind of see just a little piece of it there. I actually kind of like that, the way that looks. It's sort of a happy accident, I guess. Or maybe that's just an excuse. The other cool thing about, you know, working at Le Bernardin, even though I didn't have a blast chiller, is we had a ton of space. You know, at least for a New York pastry kitchen. You know, so whenever we did a panna cotta like this, or you know, anything freestanding that would be too soft to move around at the temperature that we would want to eat it, we could plate it from the frozen state because we had enough plates and we had enough refrigeration. So when this was on the menu, we would, you know, before service or before seating, we might plate up 20 of these on a plate, wrap it individually, and then temper it in the refrigerator. And then during service, we would always keep like three or four out to room temperature, so they'd temper to room temperature. So we were serving this at room temperature, but we wouldn't be able to actually move it around. So that's why we were able to pre-plate it, and it worked really well for us. I'm gonna take one of our little discs of sesame pain de gen. We could soak this if we wanted to. I personally find that it's, with all that almond paste, it's moist enough. Okay, let that hang out. We'll look at our yuzu meringue next. Meringue in sort of the air quotes. Here we have the yuzu puree. I was super, super excited when Boiron started carrying the yuzu puree. It's not cheap, but it's worth it. So here we have water, yuzu, some sugar, xanthan gum to give it a little bit of viscosity, and a hydrolyzed soy protein, mostly, you know, referred to by the brand name VersaWhip. So what will happen here is we're essentially, the soy protein is acting almost like the protein in an egg white. So as we start to whip this, it'll denature and stabilize the foam that's being created as we're incorporating air. The xanthan gum makes this mixture a little bit more viscous, so it actually traps more air. You know, when you have something thick, it'll trap more air. So it looks almost like the consistency of a raw egg white if we really look at it closely. It's still kind of foamy from when I mixed it earlier. What's cool about this is we can essentially make any type of flavor, again, meringue. But it's especially good for something, again, very acidic or strongly flavored. Because anytime you introduce all those little air bubbles, you know, you kind of, again, dilute the flavor to some degree. So we're going to whip this just like an egg white meringue. I also made a mandarin coulis. You see how quickly this is coming up. But we're gonna whip this to like a stiff peak. The mandarin coulis I already made for you, but it's basically just the mandarin puree, lightly sweetened and thickened with a little bit of pectin. So next we'll look at the mango spheres, and we can go back to the slides here. So alginate spherification, very, very different from what we did with the agar. So the agar is going to make a solid pearl or a solid sphere. Using sodium alginate and calcium, we can make something that's liquid centered. So again, this kind of came into fashion, 2003, 2004, 2005. Again, after Ferran Adrià and El Bulli in Spain. It's obviously a reaction that's been known for some time. It just was never really exploited by chefs. But basically, when it was introduced into kitchens, it was based on the idea that this, another seaweed-based gelling agent, sodium alginate, will form a gel in the presence of calcium. Originally, and I can't remember what the very, very, very first iteration of this was. I want to say it was apple. They would take apple juice, they would put the alginate in the apple juice, and then drop it into a water bath with calcium in it. It's kind of problematic on a couple different levels because alginate will thicken on its own, even without a strong presence of calcium. So you would already start to thicken your apple juice. And then the calcium that was first used, it's kind of a low grade form of calcium, certainly food grade and edible, but not something that tasted good, calcium chloride. And I actually played around with it very early on. Like I said, I don't think I've ever invented anything. At most, I've been an early adopter of some things. But I played with it early on, you know, when I was at Bernardin, and it just, every different, you know, liquid that you want to spherify would turn out differently because the alginate would react with it in different ways, and you had to rinse off this calcium chloride. And plus, when you made these liquid center spheres, eventually, as they sit, they eventually solidify. It's a process that, once it starts, it doesn't really end. And you kind of had to do it a la minute, and that just didn't work for me. I mean, we were, you know, working at a high level, but, you know, we were doing 250, 300 covers a night on a busy night at Bernardin. That didn't work. So I kind of shelved it. But a few years later, somebody realized, well, what if we just reverse what we put into what? Meaning we could put calcium into the liquid or the puree that we want to spherify and then drop that into an alginate bath. That kind of changed everything, and it made it really easy from a production standpoint. So I guess if we start with the alginate bath, I made this last night. Per liter of water, or 1,000 grams of water, there's 7 grams of the sodium alginate and 2 grams of something called sodium citrate. So now I've seen the alginate percentage range anywhere from 5 to 0.5 to 1%. I like to go kind of in the middle, 0.7. And you'll see, you know, this is just water. So you'll see that it is thickened a little bit by the alginate. Okay. The sodium citrate isn't absolutely necessary, but it's definitely helpful if you're working with an ingredient that has a pH below, say, 3.0, to give you a little bit of reference point. You know, a lemon or a lime or a lilikoi is probably below 3. And maybe 2.5, maybe even slightly below that. So a very acidic fruit juice or puree, the sodium alginate, it's not going to work very well unless you add this sodium citrate, which will help. The sodium citrate also helps if you have lots of minerals in the water that you're using. You know, some people even prefer to use something like what's the word I'm thinking of? Like purified water. Another interesting point about this, let's go back up here. So from a brown algae, it's not thermoreversible. You cannot melt sodium alginate back down and and form a gel again. Again, that range of pH, you know, once you get to about 3, it gets a little dicey. People have gotten around that by I've seen somebody do a tea-flavored sphere, and so they would set a tea infusion, and then just before they started the process, they would insert a little frozen cube of lemon juice or lemon puree, for example, which once it thawed out, it would acidify that tea a little bit. I find it works best when the water that it's blended into is room temperature, even slightly warmer. And even when we start this spherification process, it's best if this is slightly warm. So that's our alginate bath. And it's just water and the 0.7% sodium alginate. It doesn't really go bad. So we would often, when we did this in the restaurant, we would make several quarts of it and just keep it in the refrigerator and pull it out as needed. I also have some simple syrup. And that simple syrup is just going to give us a place to store the finished spheres. They kind of need to be stored in liquid, otherwise they would probably rupture and break on us. Get these out of the way. So, our alginate, water, simple syrup. And this is actually a little bit weaker than simple syrup. It's about 60% water, 40% sugar. And I'll talk a little bit about the choice for that as we go on. We'll turn to the mango. So here's our dosage of alginate and water. Again, the range that you'll see if you research this is anywhere from 0.5 to 1.0%. We have that sodium citrate, another, it's called a sequestrant, another ingredient you can use, and it's really, really fun to say, is sodium hexametaphosphate, if you don't have sodium citrate laying around, but you have sodium hexametaphosphate laying around. anyway. Okay, so for our mango puree, we simply took mango puree right out of the container. Again, I added just a little bit of additional sugar, a little bit of the calamansi lime juice just to boost the acidity a little bit. And here we added calcium lactate. There's different kinds of calcium we can use. Remember I mentioned the calcium chloride? I mean, it's not the stuff that we put on snowy and icy roads back east, but it might as well be. It has a very bitter flavor. But if you look at this, it has a very high calcium content. And that's probably why it was used initially. But we also have access to these more soluble calcium products. And these are things like if you buy an energy bar that has, you know, that's fortified with calcium, this is what those companies are using. It's funny because calcium lactate, when I first started using it, I assumed that it was from a milk source because of the word lactate. So I'm like, oh, my spheres are probably not vegan. And then I started doing the research, and it turns out that calcium lactate is actually made from calcium carbonate, which is kind of like limestone, that's been treated with lactic acid. Now, lactic acid is obviously something that comes from a fermentation process or it's produced in our bodies, but it's from a very benign plant-based fermentation process. So unless you are so hardcore vegetarian that you consider, 200 million year old shrimp fossils, which is essentially what calcium carbonate is, we're vegan. So we just blend that together. I just blend it again with the immersion blender, deposit it into our molds and freeze them. So this is this reverse method where we put the calcium in the puree or the liquid to be spherified. You'll also notice in the recipe there I include some xanthan gum, and that is just in case the puree is a little bit on the liquid side. Because the mango is fairly thick, I didn't add anything to thicken it. But even though we want a liquid center at the end of this, if the puree or the liquid is too liquid, it can actually cause problems for you. So a little bit of xanthan gum just to firm it up, just a tiny, tiny little bit. So we drop it into our alginate bath. And usually, as soon as I drop it in, I kind of move them around just a little bit. We don't want them to stick to the bottom of the container, nor do we want them to stick to each other. So what's happening here? As these frozen mango half spheres, actually, as we're putting them in, as they thaw, it's exposing calcium to the alginate in the water bath. The mango itself is not thickening at all. It's actually the water bath around it that's forming a gel around the mango. So it's this bath here that's forming a thin skin around the mango puree. Now, if they do touch as they're sitting in here, they will stick together. I want to avoid that. And like I said, once sodium alginate starts to gel, it doesn't really stop. So if I left this long enough, and it might take a couple days for this quantity, but this whole hotel pan would solidify eventually, just from that little bit of calcium that's in the mango spheres here. I'm going to transfer them to just a water rinse, and that's going to kind of stop that alginate from gelling. Be careful, in the water bath they can stick together as well. So once I started doing this in the restaurant, again, it actually became something that was actually very easy to do on a production level. Because as long as you had these frozen in the freezer, again, you're 10 minutes away from finished spheres. So we didn't go nuts, and like maybe one dessert at a time would have this kind of an element on it. But at one point we were doing, for one of our tasting menus, you know, we did two or three dessert courses in a row. I was doing sort of a play on a cheese course. So it was a goat cheese sphere. So we took like a soft goat cheese, blended it with a little bit of milk to thin it out and liquefy it. I don't even think we added any sugar at all. If we added any sugar, it was just a very small amount. And we would spherify it. And I still held it in a simple syrup because it just seemed to make the most sense because it gave it just a little bit of sweetness. But I would notice after I sat in the simple syrup for a few hours, they would completely shrink up. And when I cut one open, it was no longer liquid in the center. It had completely dried out, almost like the consistency of the goat cheese when it started before we thinned it out. So what that kind of shows is that this membrane, this alginate skin that forms around the outside is actually permeable. So moisture can pass through it, which is kind of an amazing thing. So I learned that if you just, and sugar is always gonna, it's a thirsty sugar. It's always gonna want to suck up as much moisture as possible. So it's always, when you have something floating around in a sugar syrup, it's always gonna wanna create equilibrium with the sugar content of whatever that is. And because there was no sugar in the goat cheese mixture, it had to balance itself out. So that's when I started doing various ratios. I think for that goat cheese, we ended up doing 70% water, 30% sugar, so it didn't shrink up too much. Another really cool thing, if you're familiar with the chef Jose Andres, based in Washington, D.C. and other places now, at his sort of signature restaurant, which is a bar with, I think, 10 or 12 seats, called Mini Bar. If you go there, you get like 40 courses, but like one bite, one right after another. And I know for a long time, their signature amuse-bouche, the very first thing you got was a spherified mojito. So I don't know exactly what was in the sphere mixture, but probably some rum, maybe just enough lime juice so it didn't inhibit the alginate from setting. And they would take the finished sphere and then put it in a foam canister, like we use for the sponge cake, and then charge it with CO2 and not nitrous oxide. And after it sits in there for a while, you release the gas and you empty out the spheres, and the spheres are actually carbonated on the inside. So again, that alginate membrane is permeable to both moisture and gas, which is kind of cool. I played around with that a little bit. I made like basically raspberry soda spheres. But the problem is, once you open up that canister, you have to serve them right away because the CO2 does dissipate pretty quickly. But yeah, kind of just a fun technique just to play around, a different way of delivering a flavor. I think that gives us enough for what we need. So let's turn our attention back to the plates. Let these sit another minute. So I have my sesame panna cotta tempering. It's almost there. I have my discs of black sesame pandagène. Let's refresh our yuzu meringue with the Versa whip. say we have a nice peak that developed here. And this is great too because unlike a conventional egg white meringue, if it collapses, you can just re-whip it, which we would sometimes do in various points in a service. We would keep this in a pastry bag, and through handling, it'll kind of deflate a little bit, but we just whip it again, and it comes right back. Take one of our spheres. Now, one thing that I've always tried to do when using these is try to put them on something that kind of encourages the guests to actually scoop it up and let it pop in their mouth. Sometimes I see it sitting directly on the plate, and I think what people do is they kind of just put the spoon in it on the plate, which is cool because you get to see a sauce develop, but you don't really get the experience of it kind of breaking in your mouth. So I always try to put it on something. Actually gonna take a little bit of this. You know, when you cut things into circles, you always have scraps. So what we would do when this was on the menu is we would dry out the scraps so we had little black sesame cake crumbs. And by using a little bit of the crumb on top, we could now put a sphere on top without it sliding off. Originally, this was a sour cherry, the griotine sphere. And that one was really, really right on the edge of being too low of a pH. We leave these in the alginate too long, it just makes for a thicker membrane, so we want to avoid that. So because it's the bath itself that's forming the skin around the sphere, usually the question is, well, can't we flavor that? You could, but again, we're talking about such a small amount that's forming that membrane that it probably wouldn't be perceptible against, you know, in this case, the mango. I would also worry that, you know, because everything has a calcium content, you know, some things are higher or lower. Now, whether that calcium is accessible is another question, but in research that I've done, like a black currant has enough calcium, we probably in theory don't even need to add much, if any, calcium to this. I've done yogurt spheres with no added calcium. But I would just worry that whatever you put into the alginate bath to flavor it would, you know, possibly affect its consistency or its ability to gel. If it's either of a low pH or if it has a high calcium content. But I haven't tried it, but I've seen it, where if you make an alginate bath with tonic water, that it'll glow underneath a black light, which could be cool if your dining room involves black lights. All right, so on the plate we have our panna cotta, our pain de gin, our yuzu meringue, our spheres. I also have a little bit of a candied orange peel. In the recipes, I include a sort of a craquant made with isomalt glucose fondant. I was worried about the humidity on that, so I decided to skip that one. So I have here a little bit of candied orange peel. It's already kind of cut into a batonnet, but I'm going to cut a thinner julienne. For plated desserts, I like to try to create a lot of movement, you know, upward movement, lateral movement on the plate. We have a little bit of micro cilantro, or we could do like a micro shiso or a micro basil, or all flavors that would work well here. Even using the herbs themselves, the kind of the natural curve of the herb to suggest some of that movement. There's kind of that hard thing to try to describe to cooks, is to make things look unnaturally natural, you know, to make things look irregular to the point where it's irregular in a very, very specific way. That only we would notice, that the guests probably wouldn't notice, but we do. Some of our mandarin coulis. Just really, really tight along the perimeter. And then our lychee sorbet. Chef, did you make these in a paco jet or in a batch freezer? But all of the recipes that I develop, they work equally well in a paco jet as well as a batch freezer. This might ruin my chance to get a free paco jet, but I actually prefer batch freezers to paco jets, especially with ice cream, because if you think about, now that we know that ice cream is basically, the structure is that fat scaffolding, when you make ice cream in a paco jet, you don't get the fat scaffolding. If you were to take a scoop of ice cream made in a batch freezer, an identical batch made in the paco jet, the one in the paco jet would melt out faster because it doesn't have the structure. This is basically just a high-speed food processor, and it's not creating that same structure. I miss this dish. I haven't made this dish in a long time. All right, so what we did for you is we just put the panna cotta into a little dish. That we'll get the same components onto it. Maybe I'm going to give this to you. We could probably get a photograph of it. Oh, question. The spheres? Again, I would treat it like a fruit coulis, so maybe 2-3 days, as long as it's kept refrigerated. Yeah, is, you know, it's more about them breaking than going bad, really. We could probably take a picture of it, but then we might want to remove the sorbet or it's going to melt out everywhere.
What I can do, Chef, maybe if I can pass it around.
Sure. Let's see if there's anything else up here I want to talk about before we get into candy. Here's an example of you that, and I'll cut some of this. An example of a dish, you know, I was talking with actually one of the bosses here at Hata yesterday, and you know, he was asking me about trends, and I don't know, that's the hardest question to answer, like what trends are happening in pastry. I mean, it depends on what your perspective is and what you're looking at. You know, maybe for some it's shiny glazes on entremets. But I mean, one thing that I've kind of, I mean, and so sometimes when I answer that question about what's trendy, I just answer with what I want to be trendy. Whether I have the power to do that or not, I don't know. But you know, this was from maybe 3 or 4 years ago, of this kind of idea of, you know, piles of stuff on a plate. And since this time, and this was kind of the guiding plating aesthetic, it seemed, for a while. You know, but for me, I've realized that it's more challenging to kind of reconstruct things. Now that we've deconstructed them, I think it's more interesting to try to reconstruct. We could probably only do like half, yeah. It's a little bit harder for us as pastry chefs because this is a very, you know, cool aesthetic. But you know, you can't really control how the guest consumes a dessert like this. You know, we might spend a lot of time balancing each of these components. You know, so this was inspired by flavors of India. So it was mango and rose and lemon and raspberry, pistachio. You know, we might, and you know, philosophically or intellectually balance out all those flavors and the sweetness and the acidity, but people are gonna eat it how they eat it. More interesting to me is how do we build things together again? You know, maybe that is manifesting itself in some of the, you know, for lack of a better word, more conservative approach that I think me and I think other pastry chefs are taking too. If you look at what's going on, you know, around the world, which we can do now in real time through social media, you know, people aren't necessarily reinventing classic ideas. We're just trying to refine them. We're trying to make them as best as we possibly can. You know, maybe looking less at inventive flavor combinations and beating people over the head with, you know, bacon and desserts, like that's done, or beets and desserts. It's cool in moderation, but you know, it's more about let's get the best possible hazelnut or macadamia nut or whatever it is, and just honor that ingredient. That's kind of some of the trends I see happening. But you know, this was kind of an early example, but also I broke my own rule here of putting those spheres directly on the plate. But all right, so we'll slowly start to wrap up here because you probably don't want to stay too late. I'll wrap up and just talk about some confections that I made for you. Remember we talked about colligative properties. So those, you know, on the low end when we talk about ice cream and sorbet, it's sugar that lowers the freezing point of water. We've all made sugar syrups. We probably made them earlier today, or we'll make them tonight or tomorrow when we're back in the kitchen. You know, when we have sugar dissolved in water, it raises the boiling point. And if we don't think about it, you know, maybe it's good to think about it in the sense that we can correlate temperature of a sugar syrup with the moisture and solids content of that syrup. You know, so a chart like this kind of shows us either based on temperature or those kind of, you know, visual tests for a sugar syrup, kind of an estimate of what that sugar content is. You know, and if we look at something like, you know, a pot de fouille, what temperature do we cook pot de fouille to? 222, 223 Fahrenheit, 106, 107 Celsius. If we look at this chart, that corresponds to somewhere in the neighborhood of about 80% solids content. And it just so happens that that's what pectin requires to form a gel like the one in pot de fouille. So a lot of the times, you know, I just don't know that too many people think about what's happening when we're cooking something to a certain temperature. We're actually reducing water, and it's the reduction of that water and the concentration of the sugar that's left that allows that temperature to rise. Of course, once we get to 300 degrees, 310, we've completely eliminated most of the water, if not all of the water, and that's when we start to get caramelization. What's caramelization? It's basically the point at which water, or at which sugar starts to decompose and break down. You know, lucky for us, decomposing sugar tastes good, so we use it a lot. I won't spend too much time on this, but you know, what makes every type of confection different from every other confection is the other ingredients that we add to it, or you know, the temperatures at which we cook it to, the types of sugars we use. You know, this is something I didn't spend a whole lot of time in when I was, you know, thinking about when I was in a restaurant world. But now that I'm, you know, when somebody makes a chocolate and confectionery lab for you, you start thinking about confections a little bit more, I guess. So I've been having a lot of fun lately. One of my favorite new things, I've always loved soft caramels. But I especially have enjoyed utilizing the Boiron purees into these caramels. So if we look at this recipe, I think it's maybe the very, very last recipe that's in the booklet. If we were simply to remove the 100 grams of raspberry puree, we could cook this like a conventional soft caramel, and it would be great. It'd be, you know, on par with, you know, a classic French salted caramel. Now, typically what I would do if I'm going for that, I would do a two-step process where I would caramelize the sugar first, and then add the cream, the glucose, invert sugar, and then cook that to the finished 245 degrees. Now what you're getting there, though, is you're getting flavor from two different mechanisms, right? You have the caramelization that you start with, and then you also have Maillard reactions. Is everyone familiar with what Maillard reactions are? So, you know, usually when we talk about browning and flavor creation in cooked food, we usually use the C word, you know, caramelization. But most of the time when we're cooking, especially non-pastry items, it's really, you know, you don't really caramelize onions, you Maillardize them. That browning and flavor creation is due more to these Maillard reactions, named after Louis Camus, and not true caramelization. So what do you need for Maillard reactions? It's when you have protein, certain types of sugars known as reducing sugars, like glucose, fructose, lactose, ribose, sugar that's in beef, for example. You have heat, and then with heat you usually have a loss of water. And under, you know, certain conditions and certain temperatures, at some point you have browning, and then the creation of flavors that didn't occur before in that product. You know, so for example, if we were to look at caramelized onions, we'll use that as an example. I'm gonna go 10 minutes over, is that okay with everybody? You have sliced onions. What's the composition of an onion? Mostly water. We don't usually think of there being protein in onions, but there's a small amount of amino acids. We usually don't think of there being sugar in onions, you know, unless we're talking about Vidalia or Maui onions, maybe. But there are basic sugars like glucose and fructose and even a little bit of sucrose in onions. So we chop them up, we put them in a hot pan, maybe a little fat, to transfer heat from the pan to the onions. We hear a sizzle, right? And we see steam coming off. That sizzle is also telling us that water is escaping. You know, searing meat doesn't seal in juices, and we know that because you hear a sizzle when you put a steak in a hot pan. That sizzle is water escaping from the surface of the steak. So you have water escaping, which we can see and we can hear. And as the more and more water escapes, the temperature goes up, and at some point we start to get browning, and then flavors that were very different than existed in the raw onion. It's not caramelization, it's Maillard reactions. It's proteins, sugars, heat, loss of water. If you know anything about caramelizing onions, you know if you add a pinch of baking soda, you can actually get that reaction to happen faster, and that's increasing the pH, which baking soda will do. So in the example of our caramel, we caramelize sugar, then we add cream, which has protein and lactose, protein and sugar. And we have glucose,
So as we continue to cook that, somewhere in the 230s, 235 Fahrenheit, we start to get additional browning and additional flavor creation from those Maillard reactions. So it's kind of a two-step process. We can also make those caramels just by combining everything together and cooking it to 245, where we just get the Maillard reactions and not any true caramelization. Dulce de leche is a perfect example of that. There is no caramelization whatsoever happening with dulce de leche. And when you taste dulce de leche side by side with caramel sauce, you realize the differences because they are two different mechanisms. Okay, what does that have to do with caramel? So one kind of cool thing that I have in my lab is a vacuum cooker. Now, a lot of commercial confectionery is done, at least in part, in a vacuum. So if you think about what a vacuum cooker might do, it's helpful to think about a pressure cooker. In Pastry Chefs, we don't use pressure cookers that much, unless we're cooking something at home, maybe. But positive pressure raises the boiling point. You know, so you can do a braise in a very short amount of time in a pressure cooker that would take longer at atmospheric pressure. Negative pressure, or creating a vacuum, lowers the boiling point. It's the same thing as cooking at altitude. You know, if you're in, you know, I'm at sea level. I'm like at probably 5 feet above sea level, which most of you probably are too, right? But if you go to Aspen, Colorado, you're almost 10,000 feet above sea level. You know, water is going to boil at 206 Fahrenheit instead of 212. Less air pressure, water boils at a lower temperature. So cooking in a vacuum allows us to control these reactions. You know, if you're making a hard candy, there's a very, very fine line between hard crack and caramel. If you do it under a vacuum, the moisture reduction that would normally happen at 300 degrees could happen at 275, so you're nowhere near caramelization. Same thing with Maillard reactions. You know, if my Maillard reactions happen around 230 degrees, what if I cook that in a vacuum? You know, for example, this here, these like the raspberry caramel you're gonna see, this was cooked at atmospheric pressure, at, you know, not in a vacuum. But these white peach caramels that I made in the lab, there's no browning whatsoever here, because what I would normally have to take to 245 here, I was able to do to 190 under a vacuum, meaning I got to, you know, at atmospheric pressure, you're not even at the boiling point yet, but I was able to get the same consistency, the same moisture reduction in a vacuum at 190, which meant none of the Maillard reaction. So it was like a very like in-your-face white peach flavor. I mean, I don't mean to, you know, bring this up, but you don't have one. And I do, but that's probably gonna change. I'm glad I finally got a laugh. I think that's changing. I think we're gonna start to see, because they're also expensive. The one I have is probably like $5,000 off the shelf. But I think we're gonna start to see machines that will do this for us become more accessible to all of us and they'll work in our kitchens. Because, you know, this looks pretty intense, you know, sitting next to your, you know, your microwave and whatnot.
How long does it take in comparison to a regular cooking caramel?
How long is it? The question is, how long does it take?
Yeah, in comparison.
It takes a little bit longer.
Oh, longer.
You know, it might take 45 minutes, but it's also hands-free. Okay. It's got an agitator, so I can set, you know, I can set this so an alarm will go off once my temperature is achieved, so I can walk away and do something else.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm still wrapping my head around other things that I can do with this. You know, I can make my own dulce de leche or condensed milk. There's actually a technique that big companies like Nestle does to make milk chocolate from fresh whole milk, because you don't want water and chocolate, right? But you can use a vacuum cooker to achieve something like that, which I've been playing with. So we have raspberry caramels for you. I'm just gonna pass around the camera. We're all professionals, right? But yeah, this has been one of my favorite things to play around with. And, you know, again, it works for virtually any puree. You know, the colors and the flavors are just a little bit brighter if we're able to do them under a vacuum. You know, it's almost like a starburst. Like, it's that bright and fruity, even though that's made by a completely different method. I'm gonna skip over the bonbons. Again, just unfortunately due to time. But I can briefly talk about these recipes. Both of the ganaches are white chocolate-based ganaches. One using banana, one using passion fruit, that are really versatile. They're meant for molded bonbons. They're really, really soft, which I think when we make a molded bonbon, we should take advantage of being able to make a really, really soft ganache. But the really exciting one is this mandarin gel that is paired with the banana ganache. You know, when I said I don't invent new techniques or anything, I just adopt them. This is totally one that I borrowed from another pastry chef, probably one of the most creative pastry chefs that you probably don't hear enough about, a guy named Jerome Landrieu, who's based in Chicago. He works for a chocolate company. But you know, you've probably seen people do enrobed bonbons where it's a ganache and then a layer of a pâte de fruits. You know, and a pâte de fruits is very dense, very firm, very sweet, right? It's, by the time you're done, it's 50% sugar or more, 75% sugar. And pâte de fruits is fine. And there's a reason why we all probably have it on amenity trays and pedophore plates, because it's easy and it's inexpensive and you can make a lot of it at a time. But Jerome was thinking about, you know, doing a molded bonbon. Do you need me for something? Okay. Changing my battery. So what Jerome realized, you know, we made these fluid gels with agar. Jerome realized that pectin, like apple pectin, yellow pectin, whatever we use for a pâte de fruits, is also shear thinning. So this recipe is kind of cool because not only does it
work like a fluid gel, like those agar components, but it uses pectin, so it's made like a pâte de fruits, but you also see that isomalt is there. Has anyone actually putting isomalt in something there that's edible? Anybody use it in anything edible? You totally can. It's not a sugar, it's a sugar alcohol or a polyol that's made from sugar. You know, usually we use it to do decorative work, but what's cool about it is that it's half the sweetness of sugar. So Jerome added it to that recipe to make it less sweet, where pâte de fruits is conventionally very sweet, in order to get that pectin to that 80% solids content, right, to get the pectin to set. So at the end of the day, what you were able to produce is a very soft, almost jam-like consistency using a pâte de fruits technique that's less sweet, but also has a high enough sugar content that it has a reasonable shelf life. Because that's the problem with chocolates too, to make something really soft and, you know, that gives you a nice contrast with the shell, it probably has a high water content, which reduces the shelf life. Anyway, that's probably one of my favorite components, especially doing chocolate work. You can do some really interesting textures, you know, inside of a bonbon. So I encourage you to check that out. It could even be used as a plated dessert component. I also made some pâte de fruits, since we're talking about pâte de fruits. I made you some white peach pâte de fruits. Before I talk about that, though, similar to the ice cream spreadsheets, I started thinking, like, what else can I apply this nerddom to? So, you know, bread recipes, obviously, if we're working with breads, I mean, we're already conditioned to think of those in percentages, even though it's baker's percentage is different. But I thought, wouldn't it be cool to apply this to a ganache as well? Because that's certainly a recipe or a preparation. It's hard to just look at a recipe necessarily and to immediately know, well, is it meant for enrobing or for hand rolling or for molding? You know, what I've done here is I've created a spreadsheet where I can plug in all the ingredients and I can get the percentage of cocoa solids, so chocolate flavor, cocoa butter, which is firmness, milk fat, total solids, water content, all of those things. That'll be another app. I'll charge you separately for it. All right, while I coat some pot de fouille for you, these are also kind of fun. I made you some gummy bears. So this recipe is kind of cool because it actually uses puree, which most commercial gummy bears are probably not starting with fruit puree. They're being flavored by very, So yeah, you can take a little bag. These are blood orange gummy bears. But this is a recipe that actually uses puree as the base. And you'll notice that there are two purees there. If you look at the recipe, we have the blood orange, which is the primary. And this is actually the first time I did it with blood orange. The color could be maybe a little bit darker, but I think the flavor is really good. And then there's also pear puree. So what's interesting about the pear puree, and sometimes if you look at confectionery labels, you know, ingredient labels, sometimes you see things like concentrated pear juice or concentrated apple juice. I think a lot of times those things are added because they add pectin, which adds body to candies. So it's interesting, even though gummies are predominantly gelatin, if you look at that recipe, it's a lot of gelatin. You get some interesting synergy with the pectin that the fruit purees bring to the table as well. And that pear, in this case, is just neutral enough where it doesn't taste like pear, but you're getting some of the natural pectin from the pear. If I was doing something like passion fruit or something tropical, I might do apricot puree to be sort of the neutral base because that's also high in natural pectin. But basically, we're just combining the purees, some sucrose, glucose. In this case, we also have dextrose and sorbitol, which kind of, again, balance out sweetness and water retention. That's cooked to a very specific temperature. Then it's poured over the hydrated gelatin, some more glucose. And now commercially, has anyone ever done starch molding? It's kind of a pain, it's kind of messy. But commercial, you know, I went out and bought some commercial gummy bears. You know, commercial gummy bears, or you could do this yourself. You could take already made gummy bears and dry them out. And then you could essentially glue them to a stick or a ruler. And you take some cornstarch. Commercially, they use a starch that's blended with a little bit of oil so it compacts really well. But you can dry out the starch a little bit in a low oven for a day or two. Put it into a sheet pan or a frame, and then simply use those dried out stale gummy bears to impress the form, the relief form into the starch. And then you can go back and, you know, with a dropper, drop in your gummy mixture and let that set in the starch. Then you can just take it out of the starch, brush them clean. You know, they would do it in like a panning machine commercially. I don't know. Not that I'm lazy, but I hate to clean up things. So starch is kind of messy. So someone close to me found these cute little silicone bear molds online. So I've got a mess of these molds. So like this recipe that as printed will actually make something like 8 or 10 of these. So we're talking like 700 pieces. But I could see this as being just kind of a fun type of amenity. I haven't done the research yet, but I started the research. I started to research companies that supply like fly fishing fanatics, because people who make their own fishing lures are really, really. It's really important to have anatomically correct bugs that they're trying to create lures from. And you can get anatomically correct worms that we could actually use to make gummy worms. But in place of that, I have just a fun little squiggly silicone mold. I'm just going to pass these around. There's not enough for everybody to take one. I can see you all doing like dirt cup, gummy worm type desserts now in the future. So, you know, usually when I make these, they take a day or two because you wanted them to dry out just a little bit. Even commercially, they go through a curing process. But when I do pop them out, the recipe there talks about carnauba wax, which is kind of difficult to work with in a small quantity because it has a very high setting temperature. But usually what I'll do is I just take a little bit of pan spray or a couple drops of a neutral oil into a bowl, and just a few drops will coat, you know, a couple hundred of these. And it just gives them a little bit of a shine. It keeps them from sticking together, a little bit of a moisture barrier. And in this case, I use a little bit of orange zest oil to flavor that as well. But fun stuff. All right, I'm going to coat some pot de feuille. I'm actually going to add just a little bit of citric acid to the sugar that we're going to coat this with. Not quite enough to give us like a gummy or a Sour Patch Kid effect, but again, I almost think that coating pot de feuille in sugar is almost like an insult to injury because there's already so much sugar in it. But again, parametric recipes from Boiron, from those brochures, are great to have. All right, I'm going to stop talking. You're going to ask me questions. OK, I guess I got to keep talking. You have to store them in something so they don't like bump around and break, basically, or stick to each other. So typically, I'm doing something sweet, so simple, like a light syrup, just seems to make sense. But I know like restaurants that have done, you know, spherified olives, they'll hold it in olive oil because that also makes sense. People who've done, you know, if you could make like almost like a mozzarella sphere and just keep that in some milk. But from a pastry application, simple syrup works for me. I'm sorry? Heat, actually heat is good for the alginate. And it's also, remember, it's not thermoreversible. So you can actually serve these warm. I'm sure somebody has done it, but I always thought doing like a French onion soup with like warm liquid Gruyere spheres would be kind of a cool idea. Any questions about the purees at all? It sounds like you all are converts to the cause. So, I mean, I'll tell you what I like about the purees. I mentioned, you know, the great technical assistance that the company has always offered to pastry chefs like us. You'll notice that I already mentioned that the amount of sugar that's been added historically has been just enough to achieve what they feel is the right balance. It's not a blanket 10%. But you'll also notice, you've probably seen it on the product that you've already been getting, the no sugar added line keeps growing. And again, that just gives us more control. You know, as pastry chefs, what we want to do. You know, and the fruit that's used, they're made, you know, the factories in the southeast corner of France, about an hour south of Lyon, beautiful area. Vineyards on one side, mountains off in the distance. And I got to visit a couple years ago, and I actually saw strawberry puree being made. So we were there for Syrah and Coupe du Monde and Bocuse d'Or, and they were making strawberry puree. And it took me a minute to, like, wait, it's January. Like, but you know, they purchase so much fruit at its height in season that it actually gets flash frozen. And strawberry is, like, you know, one of the most popular flavors globally that they actually have to make it several times throughout the year. But what kind of struck me, what was interesting about that was how they blended the fruit. You know, so wherever you think the best example of any particular fruit is, that's where it comes from. You know, so coconut puree comes from Thailand. The mangoes for the mango puree comes from India. You know, the strawberries, it was a blend, when I saw it, it was a blend of berries from Finland, Poland, and France. And I don't know if you've ever been to Finland, but they have amazing berries, so that totally makes sense. But like, you know, grapefruit comes from Texas. But they also, if something is not high quality, like I don't know if any of you remember now, probably 6 or 7 years ago, there was about 6 months, you couldn't get coconut puree. It actually drove me kind of crazy. But there was a, you know, something affected the coconut harvest in Thailand, and, you know, if it wasn't good enough, they weren't going to make puree with it. So as frustrating as that was as a customer, I kind of admire that they stuck to their guns. So you'll notice I did the pot de fouille here in a 3D mold. You know, for me, when I'm making pot de fouille, it's always a question of, okay, do I want to do the work now or later? You know, so you're making it, you could either pour it into a slab and then have to cut it later, or spend the time at the beginning to, say, mold it into a silicone mold like this. Any other questions?
Do you have a Facebook page, or do you take questions online?
I mean, you can ask the questions now, unless you think of them later. But yeah, I mean, you can find me. You can find me. Or you can give me a card, or I can give you my card. Seeing as that this is being broadcast globally as we speak, I don't know that I want to get my email address out.
This whole segment will be uploaded to
that added a lot of extra pressure. It's the live stream. All right, as long as you guys know something more than you did 4 hours ago when you came in, I'll be happy. Yeah? Okay, good. Yeah. You could. I don't think alcohol would have any detrimental effects on the alginate. You know, maybe just the viscosity of the, you haven't even know that that's really important, you know, having something viscous like a sugar syrup. Yeah, you just need them to be able to move around and not stick to each other or break each other. Yeah, I wouldn't overthink the liquid too much. Yeah, we can pass that around, or we can leave that on the table for them to try on their way out. I guess that's it. Jimmy, Maple, do you guys have anything you want to close with?
Thank you, Chef.
And thanks to Chef Matt for being the commie. Mahalo.